All right, everybody. It is 12 o'clock p.m. Eastern Time. I am Andrew Barton, the Director of Coaching Development at USA Baseball. Thank you so much for joining us for USA Baseball Virtual Community Coaches Clinic number 29. Can't believe we've had 28 of these already. We are now into number 29. If you want to see any of the 28 previous clinics, you can go to youtube.com/USABaseballTV, click on View Channel, then click on Playlists, and there will be a playlist for Coaches Clinics, and you can check those out. You can go back and review anything that maybe you've missed before, share them with your team, share them with other coaches. It's real easy to hit that share button and share them with really anybody else in the baseball world that you think could take advantage of those. They're right there for you. They're free. I'm going to say that four-letter F word a lot today because a lot of our resources that we have are free. So we're having a little bit of a technical issue pushing it live to Facebook. Hopefully we can get it in there soon. Rafiqual, I hope I said your name correctly. Rafiqual Islam jumped into the chat, introduced himself. Please do that. If you are joining us today, please jump in that chat. There's a button down at the bottom of the Zoom toolbar. Give us your name. Give us where you coach, what level you coach, where you're checking in at from all around the world. We would love to connect with you if at all possible. In addition to that, drop your social handles. I'll do that here in a minute. Drop your social handles, interact with other folks that maybe you don't know, we've had a lot of people ask each other questions throughout the chat. They've connected via social media. They've connected via email. Hey, we want this to be a community of learners, and we're glad that you've taken the time today. Maybe you're at work and you've got us on the second monitor. Maybe you've got us muted. I don't know. Maybe you are watching from home. Maybe you're watching from somewhere else all around the world, and it's nighttime in Australia. I don't know. But we're just glad that no matter where you're at, you've made the time to see us either today live here on Zoom. You're getting credit for your USA Baseball Coaching Certification Level C. Maybe you're watching us on Facebook Live. If it would ever push forward and go live on Facebook. I'm trying to figure that out right now. Having a little technical issue there. Or if you're watching us on YouTube 6 months from now, a year from now, 2 years from now, we're glad you stopped by. We're glad you joined this community of learners to get better in our great game today. Format's a little different today. Usually we do two or three speakers, then a Q&A, two or three speakers, then a Q&A. Today we're going to have the speakers go. We've got four presenters. Two of them are going to go a little longer than the 20 minutes. I got a lot of information to share. We're going to go with a presenter their entire time, and then they're going to do a Q&A immediately after. So as questions pop up in your head and you're thinking of different things you'd want to ask them, do not wait. Stream of consciousness. Just go right down to that Q&A button and type in your question, okay? And we'll get to as many as we possibly can today with our presenter as soon as they are done. So we will go with Coach Pinto, then his Q&A. We'll go with Coach Swendra, then his Q&A, Coach Odette, his Q&A, and Coach Saratori, and then his Q&A, all right? I'm seeing some familiar names pop into the chat. Thank you so much for joining us still, staying with us, staying strong. Remember, there's a chat button to interact with other folks, to drop your contact info. Make sure you click the blue button where it says all panelists and attendees. If it only says all panelists, that is only going to myself and the presenters. Make sure you have and attendees on there so all the attendees can see that as well. Rich, Moretta, man, I got worried there for a minute. You're number 10 on the list in the chat. I was concerned you weren't joining us today. Thanks for being here, Rich, friend of the program. All right. Visit usabdevelops.com for all of your developmental needs. Again, free. We've got coaching certification. We've got a high school baseball coaches manual. We've got a long-term athlete development plan. We've got a blog, and the blog posts are sorted by subject. I just found out yesterday we have a field maintenance blog and an outstanding document for any of you that are taking care of your own field. Check that out as well. We have so much good information. You can also bring fun at bat to your school districts, whether you're a coach or you have a child that's in a school district. Tell your elementary PE teachers they need to bring fun at bat to their schools. It's free. It's a program with ourselves, Major League Baseball, and Franklin Sporting Goods. They get a bat and ball equipment kit that the schools can use. They get character building books. Everything on there is approved by Shape America. The curriculum is approved by Shape America. Tyler or Anthony in our office can do that for you. In addition to that, we have Pure Baseball, which is USA Baseball's zero tolerance policy toward abuse for minors. And it's some very deep stuff that you really need to pay attention to. Okay. If you're a coach in our game today, you need to pay attention to it. We have bad actors in baseball. We're no different than any other sport. We're trying to eliminate them as much as possible. We keep a banned list on our website. That's public facing. You can see it on usabaseball.com or usabdevelops.com. And the Pure Baseball course is 40 minutes. It's hosted by David Ross, manager of the Chicago Cubs. And there's some interesting stuff on there. There's a course for minors that you should have your players watch. And there's a course for adults that anyone in your organization should watch. We also can provide any sort of organization-wide tracking that you would like. If you want to run your background checks through us, the national governing body, in addition to being Safe Sport compliant, Pure Baseball compliant, let us do that for you. It's free. Our background checks are not a revenue generator for us. They're simply a service we provide at a low, low cost. So Kyle Lubrano in our office, Senior Director of Safe Sport, can get that set up for your league, team, organization, or just for you individually as well. So please take some time, jump into usabdevelops.com. We have a ton of information on there. Long-term athlete development plan, the high school coaches manual, as I referenced, coaching certification, educational course modules. It's all free. Take advantage of it, please. And more importantly than you taking advantage of it, share it with other people. Get the word out. Tell your league. I coach my kid, 3 to 5 year old, and I've told the High Point Pony League. I've told them, hey, we have all this stuff. Why don't our coaches take advantage of it? So it's going to take you spreading the word for us. And if you do that, we certainly appreciate you. All right, Coach Pinto, let's go ahead, flip your camera on, man. Let's get your sound rolling. Our first presenter today is someone who has spent a very long time in our game, has done some really amazing things, and that is Mike Pinto. And Mike is currently, he's got a lot of titles. He's the field manager, also the chief operating officer for the Southern Illinois Miners, and the Miners are an independent league team, Frontier League team, down in Marion, Illinois. They have a tremendous stadium. They get excellent crowds. I've coached in that stadium. I've recruited in that stadium. They're in a really rich baseball area where there's not a Major League Baseball team, and they have taken advantage of that, went full throttle. They have a tremendous experience there for a lot of people, and that's because of Mike, and Mike helped build that from the ground up. So I know what you're thinking. Hey, I'm a high school coach. I'm a summer coach. What's this have to do, this guy that's in professional baseball, what's this have to do with me? Well, I think once Mike starts talking, you really understand what he had to do to get that thing rolling. There's a lot of similarities to starting a youth organization to starting a high school program. And so, Mike, thank you so much. I know you're a busy man with a lot of titles. Thank you so much for making time to join us here today.
Well, no, thank you very much for having me. It's an honor. It's truly an honor to be part of this and to share at least whatever experiences I have had over all the years. I guess as I was laying out and putting my presentation together, it kind of came together as to how I originally got the job with the Miners, and I'll explain more about that. I have a ton of visuals that I'm going to flip over to go to my share screen so you can see a lot of those. I guess the one thing I would suggest to everybody is to look at this, and I'll give some examples along the way of when you see an idea, maybe not, well, I couldn't do that, but how could I do that? And I'll share some examples of when I saw an idea and said, I could implement that, not that way. I can't afford that. I don't have that kind of budget, but I certainly can do that concept and bring that into our program. So, you know, with that, let me go ahead and start. I'm going to share my screen and at this point, can you see mine?
Yeah, you're good, Mike. Just go slideshow, and we'll be good to go.
Terrific.
Perfect.
So, again, thanks very much for having me. I am a really lucky guy. This will give you an idea of where I go to work every day. This is my ballpark. This is kind of the entrance as you first come into Rent One Park. That's our stadium. We hold, I guess, somewhere in the vicinity of 7,000 people between our berms. This is our party deck area. We have an outdoor entertainment plaza. You'll see, as you come around, these are covered, or rather, our enclosed bullpens. Our new $700,000 HD video board. And I'm bringing attention to all this for a reason. There's our mini golf course. Our players will get some time in that, get there to the park early. So as you can see, it's a pretty nice ballpark. The point I make to that is that's not where I started. I started my coaching way back in Hoffman Estates, Illinois, in their local community Pony League program. I was coaching my sons. I started at 10 years old. This is a 14 and under. I coached the all-star team, and we went to had a couple of levels we were able to advance, and those are all wonderful experiences. I had a chance to coach a travel team in Schaumburg, Illinois. And again, this all kind of came from coaching my sons. And then I got an opportunity to be a pitching coach at Oakton Community College. When Rich Simmons, the head coach, retired, I took over as the head coach and had a chance. This was our conference tournament championship. From there, I went on and was a professional pitching coach with the Joliet Jackhammers of the Northern League. Of this particular group, by the way, five of these guys ended up getting picked up by major league organizations, one of which ended up with 7 years in the major leagues. So the point I guess I'm making through all this has been a step-by-step process for me, ultimately leading to a Frontier League championship with the Southern Illinois Miners. Not one of these jobs did I ever apply for. I was asked along the way to go to some of these jobs. So whether it was getting a call from Rich Simmons saying, "Hey, I hear you're really good with working with young pitchers. You want to come and help us out and try it in the fall, see if you like it?" To when Rich retired, my having the opportunity to take over the program. To then Joliet, I had met Matt Noakes, their manager, while sitting in the stands scouting when I was scouting for the Royals. And he said, "Hey, I'm looking for another coach to come on next year," and join them. Ultimately, it led to Southern Illinois. And I guess here's the point I'm making with this. I get a phone call from a man named Eric Hague. He was chief operating officer of the Miners at that time. And they were building a brand new stadium. And he had got my name from another guy in the league and said, "I'm going to be in Chicago. Would you want to interview?" I said, "Sure, love to hear more about it." He said, "By the way, when you come, please bring a resume, because I don't know a lot about you. We've interviewed a lot of guys." Well, I guess this was the start of being different. I didn't show up with a resume. I showed up with a book. I wrote a book, a manual, leading up to the presentation, to the meeting, with how I would build a sustained organization from the ground up. And at that time, there were a group of pillars that I believed that you had to put in place in order to build something that would sustain over the long term. So what I'd like to do is walk you through what those pillars are. You're going to see how I use them now. You're going to see some of these and how I use them along the way, how I use them with young kids. But the concepts are all interchangeable and they apply no matter what. So pillar number one was that I wanted to create a player's best baseball experience. I wanted, when they look back years from now, to say, "That's the best fun I've ever had." And for us, it's little things. And we start with, for example, when we sign a player, we put their name up on the video board. We take a picture of this. This gets put on our social media. It gets made into a picture and framed and sent to the pitcher that we have coming. That also comes with a care package where he's getting T-shirts and gear from our team. Most of these guys now are coming to us. They've come from major league organizations. They've been released. They have no idea what they're walking into. And what I have discovered is little things matter. Little wows that you may be able to put in place add up to make people feel like they're a part of something special. I never, ever wanted this to be, "Oh, yeah, I played independent ball." I wanted this to be, "I played in Southern Illinois," and that meant something. So for us, we have a slogan. It's in our clubhouse. It's just about everywhere you walk around the building, and it says, "Everything matters. Every little detail matters." And by the way, you're going to see how all these come together as when I talk about creative players' best experience. You're going to see some of these and how they all come into play. But that's kind of this concept, the first concept I start with. Number two is establish winning standards. And winning for me is not winning just games, winning on the field. It is winning off the field as well. It's winning in our community. And so from day one, I sit down with our players. We have what's called our legacy meeting, which talks about who we are, where we came from, what our standards are. And it all starts with day number one, we expect to win every single day. Every day we expect to win. And everything we do is to win every day. What I found is winning is fun. So what we do is we want them to have a winning feeling from the time they pull in the parking lot. So when they get to our parking lot, for example, they're going to see the photos and pictures of players that have played here before them. They walk into our main entrance area and you can see our legacy wall of some of the great moments that have happened in minors history. One of the things I want to create for them is this feeling that there have been great players before you. And then they walk into our clubhouse and they have the honor wall down the left-hand side. Those are all the guys that have had postseason all-stars or have been signed by major league organizations. We've been fortunate. I've had, at this point, 59 guys that have signed with organizations right now. And three have reached the major leagues. We want when guys walk in to know that they were really great players. Now it's their job to take that on and take that to the next level. I was reading a book. Maybe some of you have read it. If you haven't, it's a must read for anybody in the coaching business. It's called Legacy. And it's written by James Kerr. And it's about the New Zealand All Blacks. And if you're unfamiliar with it, I know many of you are, but if you're unfamiliar with it, the All Blacks are probably the most successful sports team in all of sports history. They've won 75% of their tests, which is kind of like their games. And at the beginning of the book, they told a story. I go through this story with my players. I'm going to do it with you quickly, but this will give you an idea. I get all my players together in the dugout. And I tell them a little bit about the start of the book. And at the beginning, there's a scene where they are playing France to go to the World Cup. The All Blacks win. They go into the clubhouse, or what they call the sheds. They have their traditional toast to the player of the game. And then the two captains go into the corner, and they grab a broom, and the two of them begin to sweep the inside of the sheds. And the author, James Kerr, asked their manager at the time, "Why do you do that? Aren't there people to do that for you?" He said, "No one takes care of the All Blacks. The All Blacks take care of themselves." He said, "Well, but then why wouldn't you have the rookies do it?" He said, "That would be the wrong message. This is a message from our senior leaders to every member of our team that there is no job too small or insignificant to do at the highest level." If you saw the Netflix special a couple years ago on the All Blacks Amazon Prime that followed them through a season, you will see that there's no job too insignificant to do at the highest standard. I told this story to our players right after I read the book. Two of my senior guys went over to Menards across the street. They bought brooms. They brought dustpans. They bought a giant bag of garbage bags. And this is how we leave a clubhouse now. We leave it better than we found it. It is swept up. The garbage is put away. We want to leave with a standard that when the miners were here, and that meant something. We leave a dugout. It's immaculate. And I don't care if you're in professional baseball or high school or youth baseball. These are standards that apply to anyone. And by the way, it's everybody's job. For those of you who've ever been to Disney, you know that Disney is immaculate. But that's a philosophy that goes from everybody in their entire organization, from their chief operating officer down to the people that are actually have the job of cleaning. If you see something out of place, you pick it up. That's how we want that feeling in our organization. Well, we saw it was even done better than us. Last year, I had a lesson. We had the Japanese team was in Team Japan was in Ret One Park, our ballpark, for the Colt League World Series. And following their last game, this is what they did. They took garbage bags and they went in the stands and they started picking up all the garbage. This was all of them after it was done. We got a picture of all the kids and holding the bags of the garbage they had picked up. And I guess what I'm asking all of you as coaches is help us continue this movement. This says something about us as coaches. It says something about our players, that we have a standard. Winning standards aren't just on the field. They're not just getting a bunt down. They're not just moving a runner over. They're not hitting a cutoff man. And not throwing strikes. A winning environment is everything you do. Third is build your way. And I kind of learned this one, frankly, the hard way. I build up the minors our very first season, and we have a great first year. We are organization of the year that year, winning record in our first season, coming in as an expansion team, missed the playoffs by a day, and you know, we thought we had some things rolling. And then my pitching coach, who I'd worked all year to come up with our way of how we were going to do things, our pitching coach left. He got an opportunity to go to the Washington Nationals to be a pitching coach with them. These are all the coaches I've had over all the years. Some have gone on to become managers. Some have gone on and built academies. I have some that are head coaches. I have assistant coaches that are at major programs. Some of these are coaches in major league organizations. And one is a pitching coordinator of a major league organization. Here's the problem. When you have coaches coming in and out year in and year out, what you lose is your way because guys come in with their way. So what I decided to do was define what is the minors' way in every single capacity of the game. So our pitching program is our pitching program. Our coach's job is to be the caretaker of the program that we've built. Now, as we kind of get into some of the other sections, you know, one of them, for example, is building a learning environment. You're going to see kind of how I took this concept and put this into a learning system that you guys all have the capability to do, no matter what level that you're at. The next one, and this is a big one for me, is that spring training creates a family. I get approximately 35 players that are going to come in for spring training for us. Some are returning, maybe 25% are returning players. Everybody else is brand new. I don't know them at all. They're coming from different organizations, different styles of doing things. And I have 2 weeks to decide who gets to stay, what 24 we're going to keep, and to turn them into a family. So I've done a lot of different things. I'm going to show you what a few of them are. Again, it's not the idea. It's the concept of doing things where you're engaging with your players in unique ways. So this is, for example, one of them.
I got lucky enough to get a good song. It's just about having fun and trying to get to know the new guys.
A recording contract is not in their future.
Please get off the stage.
But Southern Illinois' newest rookies did relish Miner's Idol.
Well, the reality is I only have 2 weeks to make these guys into a family. And events off the field is what do it.
It's raining a mess.
Okay, I'm not going to make you guys go through any more of that. But it's a fun thing. We do it every single year. This year we're going to do The Voice, and we've got some new concepts with it. But we have contests. Guys get prizes. Guys get lunches at gift certificates at different restaurants. It's gotten to a point now that players have heard about it. So they come in with skits, backup singers, outfits. And so it's been a lot of fun. We've done cooking classes and competitions. Guys have got to work together. Now, part of it, too, is I've got guys that are going to host families. They've got to learn how to cook for themselves. This is a life lesson for them. So I want them to learn how to cook for themselves. We take them bowling. We go to bocce ball. One of my favorite things is this one here.
It's the magic of Wrigley Field meets Carbondale.
Grow up playing wiffle ball. It's part of the game. as being on the real baseball field. So it helps you feel young and kind of give you that exuberance and get you excited to play.
At Wisley Field, the rules have been rewritten.
There's a lot of them.
Position players pitching and pitchers hitting.
I wouldn't take notes.
What we do is I rent a wiffle ball field, and we do a barbecue. It's the day before opening day for us, and we have a barbecue. We have a round-robin wiffle ball championship. Players, coaches, trainer, radio guy, everybody's involved, and it goes back to the first ball we ever threw was probably a wiffle ball. It was probably the first bat we ever swung, and we're about to start a war tomorrow to play 100 games in about 90 days. And so I need these guys to be a family. The more I can get them off, get them together away from the field, the better off I think we are. Pillar number five is become an innovator. I remember reading the book Moneyball many years ago, and they talked in there about what they called the naive question. And the naive question was this: if we weren't already doing it this way, is this the way we'd start? So I am constantly driven by what else? Because I've always felt the most dangerous phrase is, we've always done it this way. And our game really falls into that. So I'm looking to be an innovator. I'm looking for the next idea. Frankly, I want to be playing chess while my competition is playing checkers. Now, we do a lot of different things, and I'm going to take you through a few. A couple of these are things you might want to adapt into your program. So one is we use a pitch recognition program. It's called GameSense, Dr. Peter Fatty. And it's we have iPads in our clubhouse. They're on our bus. And players are constantly going through a testing program of improving their pitch recognition. It's been a great program. Peter Fatty is an innovator when it comes to technology. It wasn't very expensive and has been something, again, we're looking for the new idea. Another thing that we implemented a couple years ago was we eliminated pitching charts. Everything went into an iPad. And we're using, I forget the name now off the top of my head. But Inside Edge, at the Inside Edge program that the big league teams use. And so everything gets charted on an iPad, everything goes up into a cloud, and we're able to pull full scouting reports on our competition. One of the things we looked at is batting average. Batting average doesn't tell me anything. It really doesn't. So we ended up coming up, Pat O'Sullivan, who was our hitting coach, came up with a concept called 4D. And what we ended up doing was creating values on four different dimensions of the game. The first is, as a hitter, ability to preserve an out. I don't care how you get on base. Just preserve your out. And so we created point structures for that. Your ability to take an unassumed base. So let's say, for example, you're on first base, guy gets a single, you go to third base. Going to second is assumed. Going to third is an unassumed base. I want our guys thinking about the next base all the time. And the old axiom of never make the first or third out at third base, that just doesn't exist with us. We want our guys being aggressive. The feeling for us is imagining a triangle in front of the outfield. If the shoulders or hips are going to leave the triangle, we're taking the next base. The next one is their ability to do their job. If there's a bunt on, do you move the runner over? Do you move a guy from second to third? Do you get a runner in from third base with less than two outs? Do you lead off an inning and reach base? So we came up with all of these different offensive point structures. And then the last one is what do you do for us defensively? So let's say, for example, you have a day where you're 0 for 3, but you saved two doubles with two guys on base. Well, those are, you helped us win a ball game that day. You may have gone 0 for 3, but your 4D value to us is really high. So we came up with some formulas, and we have a 4D MVP. As you see, he's got a presented with a belt. He gets a certificate at a local restaurant for being the 4D player of the week. The players, again, it's kind of a fun thing that we do right before we do stretch. The next thing we've done is, and I think you all could do this, and it is we started bringing in every year an umpire to talk to our players about the umpire-player relationship. The guy we use is a guy named Scott Taylor. Scott is the head of all Division II umpires, and he's the head of the Prospect League umpires as well. And he talks to our players about what really happens. How do you build a relationship with an umpire where you're getting the benefit of the call versus having calls against you? He sits down and he goes through with our catchers. How do you give me a good look? How do you give me the best look so I can call strikes for your pitchers? I want to call strikes. Help me be able to do that. So that may be something you might want to look into. Maybe you can get an umpire you have a great relationship with to talk to your players. The next thing, pillar number six, is create a learning environment. Again, with the concept of what else thinking, I think one of the most important things we can do with our players today, one of the most important, is to teach them about this. Their social media is going to destroy their opportunities if we don't help them. And, I mean, you see the horror stories today. You see guys like Ian Stewart, who lost his job with the Cubs because he got sent to AAA, and he decided he was going to go off on Theo Epstein on Twitter. You've got Jared Kocur, who had used a gay slur to describe Justin Bieber. And that came back to an article, something he put on social media. Carlos Martinez ends up with a news story because he was favoriting porn on Twitter. So what we ended up creating for our players, we do this every year, and it's a seminar called Don't Press Send. And I knew I hit a button because Rick Teasley, who was one of our former players, and Rick is a big Florida State football fan. And a couple years ago, Florida State lost a big game, and he tweeted out, "It's a good thing Mike Pinto 3 teaches us about don't press send, or I'd lose a lot of friends today." So it's something you can help your players with. If you'd like some ideas, send me an email or send me a message. I'll be glad to get information on some of the ideas that I've used. We have a rookie development program. Again, I got this from the major leagues. By the way, earlier I said I'm going to tell you where I got ideas. Miner's Idol came from the San Francisco Giants. They do that. The Arizona Fall League does cooking class for their players. I heard that. I said, yeah, we can do that. Major League Baseball, the Boston Red Sox, the Chicago Cubs, I know all do what's called a rookie development program because rookies don't know. Freshmen don't know. Kids that are coming onto your team don't know. And so we have all of our players, our rookies, come in a day early, and we teach them the things they don't know. Little things like how to sign a baseball. Where do you sign it? Where shouldn't you sign it? The fact you need shower shoes or your teammates are going to get you. Managers not called coach in pro baseball. Their skip or their first name or nickname. So we teach them all of these things. And kind of get them acquainted with what is your professional life going to be. I've gone back. I got all of our former players to write, what would I do different now as a rookie? And so it's been really helpful to our guys. Some of you might try something like that. We bring in guest speakers constantly. This is Melvin Duncan, who played with the Kansas City Monarchs of the Negro League and talked to our players about playing with Jackie Robinson and playing against Satchel Paige, and what a wonderful experience for our guys to learn about that. We brought in a military anti-terrorist specialist. This coming year, I'm trying to bring in a Navy SEAL, and I'm trying to bring in a Blue Angels jet pilot to talk to our guys about teamwork. I brought in a magician. I brought in an illusionist in the middle of a losing streak to kind of lighten up the clubhouse. What could you do? What speakers are out there that you could bring in to your team to talk about something other than just how to bunt or how to hit or how to throw strikes? For us, number seven, legacy really matters. We're trying to build a legacy in our program. Our name is the Miners. One of the things we do is we visit an active underground coal mine. We go 2.5 miles underneath the ground, as you see the picture on the right, and give guys a sense of what miners really are and how hard they work. And that sets the tone for what the legacy of our organization is going to be. We do a lot of little things. We have a helmet to the players of the game. The players all vote on that every day. The player at the end of the year that won it the most, he takes the helmet with him. We get a new one for the next year. Again, we're trying to create legacy. Number 8 is become a student of the masters of sports. I mentioned the book Legacy earlier. I have some absolute favorites. 3 Days in August, Tony La Russa's book, One Last Strike. Love Nick Saban, the book about Alabama football that was called Fourth and Down Every Day. There's some wonderful books out there, and the book, and I know a lot of people are upset over, you know, the cheating scandal, but the book Astro Ball was really good as well. A lot of ideas on program building. The Cubs Way by Tom Verducci. The Yankees Way by also by Tom Verducci. Mind Games about the building of the Boston Red Sox organization. There's so many. There is a website called Flipboard, if you haven't been to it. Flipboard, you can put in the names of people that you want to follow. And every article that comes up about them goes on Flipboard. And you're able to peruse articles and not have to dig for them. They're all kind of put on that site for you. It's called Flipboard if you want to look at it. Probably the most important, other than make this experience fun, is number 9. And this is really personal for me. Players are not a name or they're not a number. One of the things, and it's a little thing, is I never call players by their last name, ever. I think that's impersonal. And I don't want my coaches doing it either. So they have first names or they have nicknames. And that's kind of how I refer to them. One of the things that I started very early on is I told guys that if you play for me, I am going to be a coach or manage you for your lifetime. And so you need job references. Not a week of my life goes by that I don't do at least one job reference for some former player. I've helped guys get jobs in coaching and other organizations. I've watched my guys go up to pro scouting directors with organizations. That's a lifelong relationship. But I tell them that all that advice and all that comes with a price. And the price is when they leave me, I get a fitted cap from every team they ever play for after they leave. So when they leave us, they go to an organization, I get a fitted cap from every team. Some guys, I want the autograph across the brim of the cap and their new number. Some guys write letters on their caps. And so I have quite the cap collection I've kept over the years. One of the things I do every year is I do the Pinto Italian family dinner. I cook for our team. It takes 3 days to cook for all these guys. I think I did 164 handmade, hand-rolled meatballs last year. And we have a blast with it. I put pictures of great Italians in baseball around. They have to watch The Godfather and Goodfellas on the TV. I make them listen to Frank Sinatra. They play all their music in the clubhouse. The one deal I have, though, is at 6 o'clock every night, I get one Frank Sinatra song. Just, you know, you got to keep the tradition going. We have a concept called Always a Miner. And so on the left, that's one of our former players' young son. And so we send a baby tee to every one of our players when they have a child, along with a reminder that in small print in their contract that they're always part of the Miners family, as are all their children. And on the right, that's Chris Anderson. He's a former catch on our championship team. And Chris is a EMT paramedic, and he wears his Miners shirt underneath his paramedic shirt as good luck every day. Over the years, these are guys I coached in youth baseball that they still come and visit. And pictures with them and their family. From my JUCO days, these are some of the guys that have come back out to want to see me when I was in town. And this means a lot. We asked guys, and I'm just going to give these to you really quickly. Why Southern Illinois? Here's a couple responses. The talent level, treatment of players, emphasis to win with the highest standard I've ever experienced. The stadium, locker room, chairs, TVs, buses were all heads above anything I experienced in affiliated ball. I'd seen 8 teammates get signed, won 123 games in 2 years. I've been part of countless champagne showers, countless parties in Club Mineshaft. That's what they call our clubhouse because every night's a celebration. We turn into a nightclub after a win. Best of all, I've never had more fun playing than I've had playing for the Miners. Evan Mott, the high standards that come from being a Miner allowed me to have the best year I've ever had as a professional. Having that winning mindset instilled in your mind on a day-to-day basis, I feel forces you to compete at a higher level. They have the best gear, best locker room, best stadium, et cetera, et cetera. 9 winning seasons in a row says it all. If you're a Miner, you're going to win, and you're going to compete for a championship every year. I created memories and friendships that will last a lifetime. But the last slide, guys, is a couple years ago I was at the ABCA, saw a couple of my former players. And so I said, hey, if you run into anybody who's been with us, let me know. So I sent out a text to a bunch of guys and said, hey, I'm going to be at this one spot tomorrow, Saturday at 1 o'clock. If you guys can come, it'd be great to get a picture. And so these are 10 of my former players that are coaches now and in high schools and colleges and some big programs. And I'm really proud of what they've done and the coaching tree that we've been able to develop over all this time. So, Bart, I'll kind of hand it over to you. Do you have any questions?
Sounds good. Yeah, Mike, I think we've got a couple starting to roll in. I've got a couple of my own as well. Rich here's got a question. Maybe more for our hitting coach that's coming up later. Rich, I'm going to file that one away about bunting, and we'll use that when Coach Serratore jumps on with us a little bit later. Mike, I know from my background in coaching, there are a few things that resonated with me. And if you ever feel like you have a group that doesn't have a lot of cohesion, maybe you added a couple new players, maybe your travel team, you added a couple new players, those off the field activities that you do, how much of a jump do you see in I guess program closeness? Something that I always thought for myself anecdotally, and it could be right or wrong, is when you're on the field, everyone knows who the starting catcher is and you know who the shortstop is, and those roles are defined by position and by standing on the team on baseball ability. You step away from the field, how often have you seen guys who maybe don't have as large of a role on the field be a leader in the off the field activities and really step into their own light?
Yeah, there's no doubt about that. I think this is a really important part of what we do. By the way, when you talk about a new guy coming in, you know, one of the things I did not mention here is when I talk about the Miners way, we had a situation. I'm in the dugout. We have a way that we teach base running, how we want our guys to take leads on bases, right? And I'm noticing a guy at second base is not taking the lead the way that we teach it. And sure enough, bang, bang, single, he's thrown out in a bang-bang play at the plate. So my third base coach comes in. I said, Ralph, why is he not taking the lead the way we teach it? He said, Mike, remember, he came in after the All-Star break and when we went through that stuff again. I said, that's my fault. So what we've done is the Miners Way program is a video system. And so our players have a password-encoded program. When we get a new player, all of the aspects of what we teach, our bunt coverages, our pick plays, our sign system, all of those things are all on a password-encoded system. Guy comes in, we put him in front of the computer, he's got his password, and he gets in, he can see all the ways that we kind of implement those concepts. By the way, you mentioned bunting earlier, and not to get into that topic, other than something that we're trying to create, again, winning standards with our stuff. And one of the ways we do it is I don't think that you can teach bunting during batting practice. I don't think guys get it during batting practice. So we have scheduled times where my pitching coach who throws the ball pretty good. And we get our guys in there and we are live and we are hot. And I want them to bunt in real situations. We'll take the pitching machine and jack that thing up really high because they're not going to throw 50 miles an hour when the game's on the line. I got a guy throwing 94 trying to close the game out, and I'm trying to get a guy from second to third in what could be a championship for us. You're not going to do that if you're practicing at 50 miles an hour.
Absolutely. Absolutely. There's a lot of fights that go on, I know, on college campuses of the players want BP to get their swing right and to feel good. And a lot of coaches say, well, that's for the cage, man. BP is for we need to simulate the game as much as possible and challenge you, you know. But guys want to just see the ball fly when they're on the field. So, I mean, challenging your players every day in practice is something every coach should strive to do. You shouldn't just want them to feel good, because growth does not come from being comfortable. Growth comes from being uncomfortable and in those uncomfortable situations. So, Mike, let me ask you one final question here. What are some similarities you have seen throughout your long time in the game of baseball in the players? So from those 14-year-olds in Hoffman Estates to the 21 to 26-year-olds with the minors, what are some similarities that you've seen that have carried some characteristics in the players that have carried true over the years? And then what are the biggest differences that you've seen in those players as well?
First of all,
throw ages out the window.
Yeah.
How old they are, but like, what are the characteristics that you've
seen? It certainly has changed over the years. I think players today want more information. Whereas before it was, the stats and the analytics and the things didn't mean as much. You've got guys, they want Rap Soto numbers now. They want, what's my launch angle. They do want that.
Right.
I'll tell you the one characteristics that's remained the same is I think players really play hard for somebody they think gives a darn. And Joe Maddon, I got spring training is about connecting with your guys and finding a way to build that trust. At some point, I'm going to have a difficult conversation. I'm going to have that. You know, and I tell our guys, listen, you ticked off at me because I pinch hit for you last night. You ticked out because I pulled you early, you think. Do not complain behind my back. Come in and talk to me.
Right.
Now, I'll give you an answer. You may not like it. You may not agree. And it might not have worked. But it will always be the truth. And if I always operate by that, and they know that I really give a darn about them as people, then at age 14, at age 10, now in age 27, with a guy who just got released, who was in the, I had a guy who had 31 major league starts, is a major league starting pitcher. Same thing. It mattered that I cared about him. And we got him signed. He went off and he said, I'll never forget playing here. You know, you made an opportunity really valuable.
What's this? I don't know who it was because it's very widely shared, but as they don't care how much you know until they know how much you care.
Right.
Absolutely. Yeah. Mike Pinto, Southern Illinois Miners, thanks for sharing your pillars with us, how to build a program, outstanding information, so much off the field information that's extremely valuable, and a lot of things that you can put into place no matter what level of baseball you coach at. And I guess there's a difference between having a team and a program. A team shows up at practice time and shows up at game time. A program is something that carries off the field and is something that people carry with them the rest of their lives. And that's obviously something that you have built and are continuing to build down there in Marion. So, Mike, thank you so much.
If I can give you one last thing for these guys, I know some of these guys are hoping to build their careers. And if anything I've learned with my last interview is really good programs are not looking for how do you win a baseball game. They want to know how you're going to build something that is sustainable. Come up with what your pillars are so that you can present those in a way that makes who's hiring you say, yeah, you're the one.
Absolutely. 100%. Mike Pinto, thank you so much. I know you're a busy man. We appreciate you sharing with us. And I think Coach Pinto's contact info is on the presenter notes on that packet. So I put the link into the chat. Check that out. Make sure you download that and connect with Coach Pinto if you need to. All right.
Thanks so much. Bye, Bart.
Thank you, sir. All right, we're going to stay in the Midwest, but we're going to go up north where it's a little bit chillier than it is in Marion, Illinois. Rob, whenever you are ready to join us, my friend, go ahead, flip that video on. The best dressed man on the USA Baseball Virtual Coaches Clinic. Through 29 episodes, you have got the title of best dressed. And there's a lot of...
Got to look good, right? Got to look good to impress sometimes, right? Wow, what a great presentation that was by Coach Pinto. Holy cows, I was taking notes myself. That was just absolutely phenomenal.
Outstanding. Yeah, he's got really good stuff. Really, really good. Well, now it's my pleasure to present Rob Swendra. Rob is Associate Head Coach at St. Cloud State University. Highly successful program, Division II, NCAA Division II program in the state of Minnesota. Rob, thanks for joining us today.
Yeah, not a problem. Thanks for having me. I'm just fired up to be here. Looking forward to going through my outline and stuff. So it's going to be a good 20-30 minutes to get this going, huh? So yeah, very good.
Regard your starting time, we're running a little bit over as usual for these events because okay. A lot of info to share. Disregard that. Get through what you need to get through. We're going to talk outfield play. Anyone who's ever played for me knows I know nothing about outfield play. I was never fast enough to play it. I was a pitching coach for a long time, so all I did was get mad at outfielders a lot whenever things didn't go right. So, Rob, please keep all the pitching coaches happy today, and let's talk about how to have successful outfield play.
All right, sounds good. I'm going to get my PowerPoint going here real quick, and we'll get going here.
There's a few guys I'm going to have to tell that you really blew them out of the water in the dressing game.
Very good. You do that. If I can be an inspiration to somebody else, that would be great.
Absolutely.
Okay. All right, guys. Thanks again, Bart, for having me. I really appreciate it. Again, I'm Rob Swendra, assistant coach at St. Cloud State here in St. Cloud, Minnesota. And I've been a part of the program for 10 years now, my 10th season coming back. And today we're going to talk about outfield play, and I'm not going to be reinventing the wheel today as far as what I'm going to be presenting, since we're kind of right in the middle of our fall practice right now. I wanted to really get back to the basics of what I do for our outfielders, especially this year when not a lot of our guys were playing ball during the summer, or they didn't play many games at all since maybe last March. So I really wanted to bring them back and start with the basics again. Okay, so that's what we're going to be covering today. I got a few videos that I want to share with you. But today, what I always talk about with my guys. And the expectation that I have and philosophy that I have for our outfielders is simply this. Make the plays that you're expected to make. And then you go on to making the plays that you're not expected to make, and you're going to be a great ball player. Okay. So making the plays you're expected to make. Okay. So how do we get there? What does that mean? You know, every coach wants all the guys to be making the plays all the time, but how do we get there? That's kind of what I want to discuss today and moving forward. So here's a couple of things that I talk about when I talk about going back to the basics with our guys, and that could be all of our guys, our freshmen, sophomores, our returning All-Americans, guys that have the potential of getting drafted that year. We always come back to the basics. And start from the ground up, because once you have a firm foundation, you're going to be more successful doing some other things down the road. So with that said, so we're going to go over some different things that I do with our guys. I implement a hand-eye coordination drill early on. We don't spend a lot of time, you know, as far as doing the drill, maybe for a minute or two, but we incorporate just the one ball, two ball, and rapid fire drill. And I got some videos I'm going to show you guys on that and how to implement that and what we're looking for. We just take some time to go through some controlled ground ball drills. We work on them straight on, forehands, backhands, really getting proficient with just the basic stuff, getting your footwork down. And so that's so you're really proficient with that. Again, we're doing some controlled fly ball drills. working with the guys on getting behind that ball, getting the feet moving, and getting into a proper catching position. We go right into our drop steps. I think that's very important to do with our guys actually throughout the whole season. That way that they are always game ready with their footwork and the routes that they're taking. So we're always working with that. And just some drills that I, or some videos that I have for you guys to show on how we're doing that. I do use the Hack Attack a lot, the pitching machine. I think you can get a lot of repetition with using that if it's ground balls, fly balls, line drives. But I do use that a lot. And then there's nothing better than taking a read off a live bat. Okay, so there's three things that I always tell my guys that we're going to do. We're going to play the first round straight up. We are going to play the second round shallow, and then we're going to play one of the last rounds in a deeper position. That way they're working on every aspect of their game, okay? So that's kind of the outline that we're going to go with today. So what we're going to do here is I call this it's just a simple hand-eye coordination drill. We get the guys paired up, and we're going to be using – our catching hand, glove hand for this drill, and that's basically all we're going to be doing. Now, this may come by as a very simple drill, but when I get my new freshmen in, some transfers in, yeah, some of our returning guys come back in for the first time in the fall again, and we do a one ball hand-eye coordination drill, you would be surprised on how many times they drop the ball. Okay, and as an outfielder, and as a coach, you want your outfielders not dropping baseballs. So we start really down at the basics here. So and I'll show you what this kind of looks like. And so what they're doing is just back and forth, really concentrating, focusing on catching that ball with their hand, and then they incorporate a second ball as well. Now, take a look. They are not using their glove, okay? Most of these drills that we do are going to be bare hand. If they can catch 10 out of 10 baseballs or 20 out of 20 baseballs with their bare hand doing these drills, pretty much guarantee they're going to be able to catch the ball with their glove, okay? That's the concept that I have, and that's why we do it without the glove. And then at the end there, we saw the rapid fire. We use about 10 baseballs for that one, and we're just really trying to pepper them as fast as we can. And again, the goal there is to keep their concentration, their focus on just watching the ball into their hand. So simple drill that can be done at any age level. It can be done at the youth level, high school, college. I mean, any level can take advantage of this drill. It's really simple to do. It doesn't take a lot of time. All right. So from there, we basically go right into working on our drop steps. I think this is really important. Again, I run into a lot of situations where our new freshmen that come in, maybe our new transfers that come in, when doing drop steps, I do see them doing it the incorrect way. A lot of times they'll just drop step with their left foot, let's say, and then just take a direct route diagonally, which is maybe not the correct route. What I want to do here is teach the guys from their ready position to really open up their hips, okay, and run a route straight back, okay, and then they're able to find the ball, and then they can come around and then catch the ball. So we'll see what that takes a look, what that looks like here for drop steps. As you can see, the players are throwing the ball to themselves on this one. Most practices that I do, I will be doing these throws. I like to challenge my players. If you make it too easy for them, it's not doing them any good. So a lot of times I will actually give them a little bit harder toss out there and make them work for it a little bit. Tracking a ball, you know, running and catching a ball with a bare hand, you know, is you would think it'd be easy, but it's not. We do have competitions during these drills. We don't want to make it redundant for them, so they have to work for something. If they miss a ball, I actually leave it up to our upperclassmen, our seniors, or our captain that's on the outfield squad to come up with something. So if they have to do 10 push-ups or whatever it is, if they drop the ball, they have to do that while we all watch them. So they have to be held accountable, take these drills seriously, and if I see something, we'll stop, we'll talk about it, and go to the next one. So so what basically we'll do on these drop steps is that we'll do each way. So we'll drop step and do two or three times to the left. We'll drop step and do our to the right, and then we'll also do one straight back. And then we'll also incorporate what I call the wrong read situation and work on those. So this is just another one that we're showing the guys just that we're working on drop stepping to the right. Now, what I would like to see these guys do here is once they catch the ball, get into a good throwing ready position to finish the play. And so if I'm not seeing that, I will then remind our players to go ahead and make sure that they are getting into a good throwing position after they catch the ball. And so I would really encourage you guys to do the exact same thing. So if they catch the ball and they run another five or six steps after that, that's not acceptable. They have to get to a good throwing position as soon as they can. So like I said earlier, guys, a lot of these drills are pretty basic, pretty simple, but we have to start someplace to get to a better place. All right. One of the last ones here is just drop stepping straight back, trying to get it over the outfielder's head so they have to make a nice Willie Mays catch over their head. And we'll do this one two or three times as well each way. And like I said, don't make it easy for them. Challenge them. Make them run a little bit. So on these here, since they're throwing to themselves, they really didn't challenge them as much as I would like to see when I'm doing it. But get them running. My outfielders do a lot of running during our position practice. We are always on the move doing something because that's what they're going to be doing in a game. Okay? And so like I said, what I'm looking for here is it's a straight line back, keep an eye on the ball, making a good play, using your best natural athletic ability to make the play. And we work on this two or three times a week. Maybe it's only for 10 minutes, maybe it's 20 minutes, maybe I do get a whole 45 minutes with the guys. But we take advantage of it, and we go over this stuff on a regular basis. Okay, so now we're going to talk a little bit about just our controlled ground ball drill. I encourage everybody to use as much space as you can. Since we are right in the middle of our fall ball, we have access to our facility. And so we are on the field here working out, using the whole outfield on this drill. And what we're going to be doing here is really just working on ground balls right at you, and then we're going to move guys right to left so they can work on their forehand, their backhands, reverse pivots, working on their footwork, and really breaking down the ball. So in this first video here, you're going to see the guys in this one. You're going to see John here. I always want those guys to take their first two or three steps. That has to be their most explosive steps in this drill. They have to get going to that ball very quick. If they become lazy to a ground ball, I am going to call them out on it. If you are lazy to the ball, that's going to give the guy that just hit the ball a better opportunity to go from first to second base on you. And I have seen that. And so that is not going to happen on my watch. And so I always emphasize this drill a lot with the guys. As you can see, John here, his first two or three steps are really, really explosive. And getting to the ball and cutting down that gap as fast as possible. And then we just kind of pair up the guys, and they go back and forth on that. And again, as you can see here, they're not using their glove, okay? They are doing this bare hand. So my philosophy is if they can make this play barehanded, they're going to be able to make this play with a glove on, okay? So that's the ground ball one. All right, here's another one where we're going to be moving the guys around a little bit, moving them to their left, to their right. this one, I'm always about challenging our guys and not making it easy for them. So when I'm actually throwing the ball to our players, I'm making them run a little bit for this one. I want them to be able to get on their forehand and get into a reverse pivot and get into a good throwing position, but they have to work for it. Just like they're cutting off a ball in a game situation, trying to hold that runner from going from first to second, okay? And in fact, yesterday at our practice, we actually worked on these quite a bit where we would be throwing the ball down the line and they'd have to get to that ball before it hit the fence. That way they can either incorporate the slide pop-up drill or whatever it took to get to that ball as fast as they can, running the right route. And so they can simulate holding that runner to a single versus having them turn it into a double. So with that, that's the same one here. Yep, we're just showing that John going to his left there, coming up to a throwing position. Again, I would like to see these guys spread out a little bit more in this drill when I'm doing it for them. That way we can get them running a lot further distances and more realistic game-like situations. Again, they're coming up with a good throwing position on this drill. So and then again, we're just moving the guys, moving them around a little bit, going to the right, going to the left, and doing a lot of repetition. You can get a lot of reps in a short amount of time on this, and we get a lot of work done. So, all right, let's see here. Yep, doing the same one there. Very good. All right. So, just a recap, real quick. When I say my philosophy is, you know, make the plays you're expected to make, it really comes down to the basics, okay? If we can be proficient in our footwork, we can be proficient in hand-eye coordination, being able to catch the ball on a regular basis. If you can, run your routes correctly, you can drop step correctly, you're going to be making those plays, those routine plays, 100% of the time. And as a coach, that's what I want. And that's what we strive to be as far as my outfielders go. We got to make those plays 100% of the time, the ones that we expect them to have, okay? And now, so making the plays that you're not expected to make, okay, becoming great. So really, what does this mean? This means as a coach, you're sitting in the dugout and one of your outfielders makes a play and it makes you go, wow, what the heck just happened there? That was an awesome play. Held the runner to a single versus a double. Maybe he robbed a home run. Maybe he ran one down in the gap. Whatever those plays are that make you go, wow, that's what I'm talking about here. So I'm going to talk about a couple of the drills that I implement that we can work on so that when that situation happens in a game, we're going to be prepared for it. And so one of them is the wall fence awareness drill. This is the one that I work on the most in the fall. Since we have access to our baseball facility, I want to take advantage of using our fence, our wall, for our guys, since that's where we're going to be playing our home games. So we do a lot of work with that. We're going to show you a video on how we're going to do that, what I'm looking for. But we work on that. I implemented that about 4 years ago, the wall fence awareness drill. I was noticing guys in games when it came down to those plays would run a perfect route. They would drop step, run a perfect route. But when they got to the fence, they would back off and then play the ball off the fence. Where I was thinking, yeah, if they would have kept running that route to the fence, they could have made a play on the fence, you know? And so I changed my philosophy. I changed my mind on this whole concept of that play. So we really take a lot of time on that wall fence awareness drill, because we got to make those plays if we want to be great. So, again, I have the hack attack on here. I do use that in these drills. I will set it up and I'll launch fly balls to the guys. So they have to run them down, make it challenging for them, make it more game-like. And we can do it with the fly balls, the line drives, the ground balls, whatever it is, we can use a hack attack. I encourage their guys to lay out whenever they can. I encourage them to dive whenever they can, because in practice, If you're expected to make that play in a game, you have to make that play in practice as well. And the only way you're going to get better at it is by doing it. And so if I see somebody that hustles out there and then just slows up right before the ball lands at their feet, that gets to me a little bit. So I teach my guys to have that aggressive mentality. It's your ball until it's not. We're going after that ball every single time. Work on the gap, the line cutoff drill, and then the do or die throws. I think that's important. The do or die throws when that game winning runs on the base and you have to come up with a fantastic throw, you know, how are you going to do it? Well, if you haven't practiced it, you're not going to do it successfully, right? So we work on that a lot, trying to get the guys to use their own natural athletic ability to come up with a great, great throw. We'll either have a catcher at home plate, or we'll just even have a little screen set up where they have to hit that on a nice long one hop. So I got a couple videos here. I just want to show this one real quick, the wall fence awareness drill. As you can see, we're not too far away, but I want the guys to be comfortable with that fence right behind them, okay? And the goal with this drill is to have the guys take their eye off the ball, okay? Take their eye off the ball, find the fence, and then come back to the ball and make a play, all right? Seems simple, but for some guys, it's very, very difficult on that. So we'd spend a lot of time in the fall working on this since we have the facilities to do it. So I'll just kind of show you here how that kind of looks. So you can see John's there. He's taking his drop step back. First thing he does is find the ball or find the fence, and then comes back to the ball to make a play. Okay, and then we'll do this. We'll actually do this as many times as the guys want, so they can feel comfortable with it. And it works. In our first fall scrimmage this year, we had our senior captain just make an absolute fabulous play at the fence, jumping and robbing. It probably wasn't a home run, but it was probably going to be a double off the fence, maybe a triple. And I would say when he first came in, he would not be making that play. So we work on it all the time, okay, over and over again. So and again, we're just doing the same one here. Okay. So, line drive drill. You guys are going to think I'm crazy, but I'm just I'm taking it to the basics. This is all it is. It's basic stuff, right? But it's important game-like situations that I want to work on. So when it happens in a game, it's going to come natural to the guys. Okay. So in this drill, I'll show you the video here. We have these guys in a full sprint. Okay, it's 100% full sprint, and we're just chucking line drives at them. Okay, and so what I would also like to do here is really, like in all my other drills, is just challenge the guys. Okay, if it's too easy for them, it's not doing them any good. Okay, so that's basically all we're doing. We're going to go from left to right, right to left, and we're going to do this 3 or 4 different times. And when I'm basically chucking the ball at them, I'll even throw it out there to challenge them more so that they have to dive for it, even if it comes down to that. And then again, we're coming back from the other direction. Here we're trying to challenge them a little bit more so they have to get out there and reach for it. A couple of them, I think, missed the ball here, but it's 100% all the time. If you can get it to be more game-like, realistic for them, it's going to benefit them in the long run. So, and again, it was just another video there of them going. Like I said, pretty simple, pretty basic stuff on the drills that I do. Okay. And so you guys are probably thinking, like, you know, wow, that really wasn't very informative, but I wanted to just – get that out there where you can start at the basics, get a foundation, and build from there. And if you can get those guys to be proficient at doing these drills, that's going to relate to that right into the game, okay? And then also I'm going to just finish up with one thing here. as far as getting your guys to make those plays that you're expecting them to make, making the plays that you're not expecting them to make – there's a couple other things that I want to that we do at St. Cloud State. And one basically is talking about just baseball in general, baseball knowledge, baseball IQ, right? My theory is if you think the guy knows something, he probably doesn't. Okay. So I want everybody to be on the same page from the beginning. So what I do is, I implement a classroom setting. Okay. Where I can get my outfielders to come in and we just talk about situational awareness, situational stuff. We draw on the board different plays that may happen in a game so that we can all be on the same page. Because really, when especially when freshmen come in, maybe some transfers, there's a lot of time they don't even know where to throw the ball. And so we talk about those situations. And it's a really good opportunity to really get to know your guys as well on a more intimate basis, one-on-one versus, you know, the whole team and really have some really good conversations about the game of baseball. And so if you're not doing that, I would really encourage you to take 10 minutes, 15 minutes of your time and just have a good classroom setting to go over a lot of these things and get the chalkboard out. I call it chalk talk or the whiteboard and just start drawing some things up on the board. Other things we talk about is communication. If my guys are quiet in the outfield, that's just not acceptable. They got to be talking out there. They got to be reminding each other what the situation is. Maybe they have to remind them to back up on a play. Whatever they're doing, they have to be talking to each other out there. Maybe they have to be talking about, hey, remember the field is soft today. Maybe it's, you know, maybe what they're talking about, maybe the conditions are very dry. How are we going to make these plays? Always, always talking, okay? Communication is great. You're always aware of the weather conditions. Outfielders, you could have the wind blowing in, blowing out, blowing left to right, right to left. That's going to change, your routes that you may be taking. So weather conditions are something that you have to pay attention to. And that we always talk about before a game. If we're going in front of a road trip or wherever it is, I'll be talking with my guys for maybe 2 or 3 minutes before the game. Hey, you see the wind's blowing from right to left today. So in these situations, you're going to want to do this, you want to do that. So always have that in mind before a game, always talking about the little things. We also talk about scouting reports. I know sometimes maybe in youth baseball, high school baseball, you don't have a lot of those scouting reports. We use diamond charts. If we have the information on our opponents, we will talk about that with a team. I will then also take my outfielders and talk to them individually, one-on-one as a group with a scouting report might be for that day. I also do some outfield cards for the guys. I will make those up so they can have in their back pocket because I'm not sure about you guys, but when I'm in the dugout and maybe there's a 20, 30 mile an hour wind, if I'm trying to yell at those guys to move in, move back to right to left, it's sometimes challenging. So if they have that information right in their back pocket, they could pull it out and say, hey, this guy's a pull hitter. We got to take 3 steps this direction. Makes it a lot easier. And there are sometimes we have that information, sometimes we don't, and we just kind of go with it. So other than that, we just kind of review different things. Like I said, communication is huge. And I always, always, I'll end with this, I wanted to tell my guys, if you have a question, don't be afraid to ask. No questions is a dumb question for me, okay? Even as simple as it is, because I like to get to the basics and build from there. Maybe it's a situational question. We'll talk about it. That way, if it happens again, they'll know exactly what to do. So that's kind of my philosophy with the outfield play. Like I said, it was very basic stuff, but it's important things that every program can work on. And if you can be proficient and get your guys to be proficient with that, you guys are going to be that much better in the outfield. So Bart, that's what I got today. So when I went through the first time, it was 21 minutes. So I'm not sure if I went too fast or if I spoke too fast, but that's the information I got today.
It's really good stuff, and you touched on it. I think something that we really, really need to keep in mind is, now this is not everybody, but I'm going to make a general statement. A lot of people think the higher levels that you go in baseball, it's it's completely different ways of teaching, and the drills are far more advanced and the terminology so much different. And that's not really it. It's you get a lot more time with your guys and you focus on them doing those little things right over and over and over and over. That's why when someone's been well coached, your job's easier, Steve's job's easier, my job was easier. When you get to, when they get to you, man, you really got to reinforce those good habits, because doing the little things right adds up to wins and losses in college baseball. There's not as big of a talent discrepancy to where, like, you've got way more talented kids at age 13. You can make some mistakes and still win a game. You get to your level of high level of really, really good Division II college baseball. Right. And it's those little things that are the separators, because the talent's kind of, you know, for the most part, it's evened out, right?
That's correct. That's absolutely right. And I'll take it one step further too, is that when I'm talking to my guys about these drills, let's say that we're talking about a drop step drill and they're not doing it correctly, I just don't say do it again. I will stop them and we will discuss why we're doing it this way, you know, and come up with a situation where they can put themselves into that position and say, you know, that makes a lot of sense. You know, so there's some validity behind that, so that it's just not me just saying you did it wrong. Right. So, so like I said, over and over again, if you can be proficient at these little things, it's going to make everything a heck of a lot easier when it comes to the outfield. And I want to emphasize doing those drills the right way as well. But also what I see a lot of guys with our new guys, our freshman guys coming in, is that communication, situational awareness is huge. I think that when you're in a game and you got a guy going from first to third on you, should you throw it to the third base or should you try to keep that double play intact and throw it to second base? When they first come in, almost 9 out of 10 times, I'll see them throw it to the wrong base and we'll stop and talk about it. But after you keep pounding that into their head, then it's just going to come natural to them. So when that play happens again, that they throw it to the right base. So encourage that. Encourage that talk. Encourage that dialogue, and your program and your outfield will be a lot more successful.
Awesome. We have a question here from Jim Konigsberger. In the line drive drill, what's the footwork for the drill and the footwork to the transition of making a throw?
So on that one, basically, my goal in that drill is to really get the guys comfortable and used to running at 100% and really just trying to keep their eye on the ball to make that catch. Okay, because as you know, when you're running down a ball in the outfield, if you're running hard footed, whatever, that ball is bouncing on you, right? And so the goal is to really get them to have soft feet. So when they are running at 100%, that ball that's bouncing on them when they're running is minimal, and then that they can get more used to just catching that ball. Now, we really don't go into a throwing. I'll get into a good throwing position after that, because we'll do that on other drills. This one is more focused on just getting them comfortable competing at that high level to track down that line drive, basically running at that high speed and being able to have the hand-eye coordination to make that catch. So that's kind of what we're doing with that drill.
Awesome. One more quick question here from Rich. And Rich, I was actually getting ready to dive into throwing a little bit as well. It's the question I usually ask the positional coaches, the infield guys, the outfield guys. What do you recommend for a youth arm care program for outfielders? And I know youth baseball-wise, I err on the side of, and even in college, throw more often. I mean, what do you think a youth, let's just generalize, let's say a 12-year-old, 12 to 14-year-old, what should they be doing for an arm care program other than bands, right? Jager bands or something similar. Pre and post, you know, throwing long toss. Like, how often should they, or how often do you guys throw two bases?
So that's a really good question. And when I go down to one of my local little league fields here in my hometown, you know, I don't see enough of coaches working with the players on their throwing ability. Okay, so I would really encourage a good throwing program. But as far as the arm care goes, I'm kind of old school, okay? Jager bands and all this stuff is all awesome stuff. We use it at St. Cloud State. But I'm a fan of the long toss when it comes to the outfielders. Build up to that. You know, don't try to do something that you can't do, but just keep building up to doing that. And as far as what we do at St. Cloud State, as far as how often we throw it to the bases, besides you're doing regular innie outie stuff or maybe working on double relays, we try to have our guys let them open it up, let her rip probably once a week if we're outside. And that day was yesterday for us. And so we did a lot of the double relays, a lot of the do or die type throwing situations, tagging, throwing guys out. That's the day that we work with our guys on their throwing ability. And we'll even take it a step further sometimes and actually have a radar gun out there so we can chart, hey, you're at 85 miles an hour. We want you to get here. We got to do this to get you there. So as far as the youth goes, playing catch is a great start. You got to learn how to play catch, you know, and then build up from there, back up, get a little bit longer and toss. But like I said, don't do something that you can't do. Don't try throwing it from the right field foul pole to the left field foul pole if you can't do it, right? But build up for that. And then from there, you're just going to get stronger, I think, in my opinion, for the youth level anyways. So that's what I would do. Work on just playing a good game of catch, get good at it, and then build up from there with long toss.
I know we've talked about with catchers before and like adding and infielders too, adding extra reps. So like when you're doing your throwing routine, you're able to work on your transfer. You know, whether you're a catcher, an infielder, whatever. You're an outfielder, you're playing long toss. It's a really good opportunity to practice your footwork. If you're playing long toss correctly, the ball's going to have some air underneath it. It's going to get to a high arc.
Right.
It's a really good opportunity to mimic outfield play, right? And practice your footwork, get behind the ball or start in and work back.
Yep.
While you're simultaneously, that's just extra reps, right?
Yeah. So what we do with our guys is we tell them to do something with the baseball, okay? Don't just play catch, do something with it. So like for our outfielders, if they're playing catch, they're going to incorporate just tossing the ball up to themselves and going from that catch proper catching position right into their throw to their partner. Or maybe it's going to be working on their footwork as far as, you know, the glove side down, coming up into their throw. So they're always doing something different as far as even our infielders and our catchers are always doing something with the baseball when they're playing catch. So, but for our outfield, definitely going to be working on that. Now, once they start getting out longer for their long toss, I will also have them work on their long one hops to their partner because – low throws are good throws in my book, okay? So if you can get a nice long one hop to your partner and work on that, that's going to translate right into a game situation as well. So even though you want to try airing it out, we don't want too much of an arc, but we want to be able to get there and also work on those long one hops as well.
Absolutely. All right, I know we're pushing up on time. Rob Swendra, St. Cloud State University, thank you so much for sharing with us today. Outfield play and the drill series, we appreciate it.
All right, thanks a lot, guys. Appreciate it.
All right, we'll go from the cold north down to the warm and sunny south. It's my pleasure now to welcome head coach at St. Leo University, Rick Odette. I've known Rick for a long time and has always had a stable of really, really good pitchers. He was at St. Joe's University up in Rensselaer, Indiana, and now down at St. Leo. Rick, thanks for joining us, my friend.
Thanks for having me, Bart. Good to see you, buddy.
It's good to see you, too. I usually see you in a social setting, so it's good to see you in a professional setting. So I'll have to let Timmy know that Diamond Sports Promotions is well represented here today at the USA Baseball Clinic.
Please do. Please do. Always good seeing you. And usually, yeah, a little bit different than this. But, yeah, I apologize for my background. We're in the quarantine time of 50% in each facility. So I'm not in the offices. So I'm in the press box. This isn't it could be worse for sure.
Absolutely. I thought you'd be out with the palm trees, man.
I was going to. It's a little hot. It's about 95 today, so I just got off the field, so I got to go back there in a little while, but glad to be here.
Good for you, man. Well, let's talk pitching.
Okay, so I put a PowerPoint together. I'm gonna see if I can here share my my tech skills, which is going to be pretty limited, but see what I have. Let me know if you start to see it or not.
Yeah, that's step one. You're good. You roll into play the slideshow, and I think you're
all right. Yeah. I think we're there. Okay. So as you can see, this is something I've been fortunate. This is going to be my 22nd year as a head coach, and specifically, I've dealt with pitching pretty much every year. I've always been in a situation that if I did have a full time guy, it generally was going to be a hitting coach. My background playing was pitching. But also You know, I love being the head coach, but pitching is kind of what gets me going for sure. And something we've been fortunate to be able to help establish some guys. And a lot of times what happens, I think everybody, when you get on these calls, a lot of it, you know, some people are like, well, that doesn't really relate to me. And I think it's all relative. I heard Coach talking earlier, the difference between college players and then going down to the local Little League and trying to get people to understand that the fundamentals are the fundamentals. And everybody has a belief. You can get on Twitter. You can get on anything you want and find a different way to do it. But the biggest thing I think is you've got to find what works for you, what works for your program, for the ability of the player that you're dealing with, and then stay with it and then add to it. I don't think anybody can go to a class or get on this call and say, hey, I'm going to do it exactly like Rick Odette does at St. Leo. That's impossible. So what I would encourage, especially I think pitching guys, I give all my buddies a hard time, the hitting guys, like, you know, you guys act like you're solving the world's problems every time hitting happens. I think pitching is a little bit more stable when it comes to, you know, changing things up and so on. I think the bottom line now, and everybody's in this conversation, is when to use, you know, some of these things that are going on right now, some of the knowledge that we have with plyos and weighted balls and, you know, all this other technology, is how to use it within your program. And some people will have that opportunity and some people won't. I think the start of this in our first slide probably makes the most sense. Keep it simple, stupid. I've said that 1,000 times in everything we do. And the bottom line is, does it play at the plate? So when you're teaching pitching, it can have the best spin rate. The breaking ball can have depth coming from everywhere, all those type of things. But bottom line is, if you can't get a guy out, it really doesn't make a difference what the spin rate is. If you can't throw it to where you're supposed to throw it, it more times than not, you're going to be hurt by that of not having control of location. So, and obviously, if you can't stay healthy, it doesn't matter how hard you throw. You won't be pitching. So our biggest thing is try to simplify it the best we can. I think when we bring our guys into the program, we try to get them to do what they do best. We don't recruit them if it doesn't fit to what we do. Now, some high school coaches or travel coaches, you know, will not have that luxury. But I think the biggest thing for a lot of coaches is try to find what makes the most sense, you know, within their program. So for our program is we want to try to keep it as simple as we possibly can and then update. Like, we have Rep Soto. We have a lot of video technology. We have a lot of things that we feel can help us. But the bottom line is, if a guy can't repeat something or a guy can't get himself and his body moving in the right direction, it really doesn't make any difference of what information he might have if he doesn't know how to utilize that and perform. Okay, so as we kind of do this and we talk about our fall goals and goals, and your goals are going to change depending on what time of year you're in. You might only see your kids for the summer. It might be 3 months throughout the summer. It might be our fall goals are going to be much different than what our spring goals are. Spring goals, this is as a staff, you know, become a little bit different because result is a major, major piece. Here we're trying to put the base in. We're trying to get ourselves in an opportunity to get people to understand exactly who we are. I hope that once you're done with speaking to one of our players, they can tell you exactly what our philosophies are, what we're doing, what our daily routine is, and that once they get done here, they actually can teach it themselves. I think a guy for us can teach somebody else how to do it, then we've done a pretty good job as a coaching staff. So we'll kind of go through some of our goals throughout the fall. Tempo. You see Major League Baseball, Rob Manfred and all them are trying to change, you know, to speed the game up. I'm not sure how much I agree with all of the techniques, but I will say this. I agree that the game needs to be quicker, and I think the pitcher can help that for a lot of reasons. The biggest thing for us, if you play one of our teams, is we want to make sure our guys are ready to play. And when they say that, is if the pitcher's taking 19 to 23, 24 seconds on the in between each pitch, the game's going to slow down. And what happens there is your fielders, obviously things get slower. Your dugout energy changes. A lot of times the pitcher then falls into a slower motion. We want them to be able to get it, get the baseball and get things moving. And what that allows them to do is to maybe think a little bit less. Sometimes you'll have to step away and slow the game down without any question. But I think a lot of times people overanalyze, and from one pitch to the next pitch, they want to change everything they can. For us, we want to try to keep it as simple as we can and get the baseball and pitch. Throwing strikes, you don't have to be a genius to look at numbers and mathematically see where, you know, per batting average, exactly where the numbers stand. If you see a 0-0 count compared to a 1-2 count compared to a 3-1 count, that changes substantially. Okay, so if you're just playing the numbers alone, just on their own, and you look at the numbers per count, it doesn't take a genius to figure out I'm going to be much better with success rates at a 1-2 count rather than a 2-1 count. So that 1-1 count is such a big difference between one pitch being a strike and one pitch being a ball. So we want our guys to understand that throwing strikes is key. Throwing quality strikes, and we'll talk about that, the difference between control and command. We'll talk about that a little bit as well. So as you, no matter if you're teaching the little leaguers or if you're teaching, you know, college-level guys, throwing strikes and counts become a huge deal. Yes, pitch design, things like that, those are advanced. There's without any question, we want to teach our guys pitch design. Once they can control the baseball, if we cannot, design pitches that are not in the strike zone. So that makes it pretty difficult for us to be able to design a slider when he can't throw the slider for a strike. Okay, so we want him to make sure that he can have some feel for it and mechanically can get himself, you know, to both sides of the plate. Pitching inside, own the inner half. This is more of a philosophy piece and obviously one of our goals. For us, pitching inside is who we are. We're okay with hitting people and not intentionally. But if we hit somebody with a purpose of trying to go inside, that will never be something that's frowned upon within our program. It never has. If you listen to most hitters, when they get to a two-strike count, they eliminate the inner half of the plate. And it's funny because we have pitched that way for a long, long time, and I don't think it's a secret. This is not somebody that's going to come in and say, you know what, they want to pitch inside. Yeah, you can go ahead and prepare for that. But if guys aren't used to seeing it, which most are not, it's really hard with two strikes to be able to swing on an 0-2 pitch on the inner half. And what I would say is if you do not have great arms, you don't have those velo guys that you can blow away out or spin a breaking ball or something like that, if you can control the inner half up in a count, more times than not, you're going to be in pretty good shape. Now, if you're 2-1, and you don't have velocity and you're trying to go inside and a guy can cheat on you and be able to drop a barrel in the inner half, the day's going to be pretty long. But otherwise, you know, we feel like if we can get the inner half, control the both sides of the plate, and a lot of times with two strikes, we'll go back to the inside part knowing that they've basically have given the inner half away for us. Throw any pitch at any time. Again, this will all be dependent on what age group you're dealing with. But I do think it's relative to your age. If you're a fastball changeup because they're younger kids, you're not throwing the breaking ball yet. If you can throw a 2-0 changeup at 11 years old, they're in pretty good shape. And I think that is something that can be controlled. Control the running game. Controlling the running game, if they get on first base, which is going to happen, okay, if you can control the running game that you're not giving the ball to second base, you're not, or giving the runner up to second base and giving the runner up to the third base, you can control the running game. If you can do that, you're in pretty good shape. What happens, I saw this as my son was growing older in travel baseball, it's not that the catcher can't throw the guy out of second base. Generally, it's because the pitcher is about a 1-8, 1-9 to the plate. So our job is to try to get them to be a little quicker to plate. In an ideal world, we want to be a 1-4 or better, which I know some people say 1-3. I'm worried about quality of pitch before I'm worried about how fast I am. Because if I'm below 1 to the plate, it's probably too quick and my arm will drag behind. And if I'm slower than 1-4 to the plate, it's going to give him an automatic pass to get to second and third base. So what we want to do is we want to control the running game. And how we do it is we offset timing. I'm not going to get exactly how we do it, but we will offset timing pending the situation. A lot of times it's controlled from the dugout through myself. But if we can offset timing, we do not let that guy get a certain time up on us. And I say that if you were to use Lions, which is our nickname here, L-I-O-N-S, if you always go between the I and the O, so if you're at L-I-O, that's how we would do it. A lot of people do it UCLA. Okay, people will do different things. But if you're always set on time between the I and the O, by the third or fourth inning and you have guys on base, the first thing that comes in is, hey, he's on the same time. So it could be 1,000 hold, or between the I and O, however you count it. So I would just try to offset your timing. We have a set timing depending on what part of the game we're in and what our guys do. So that takes a little bit less thinking away from them so they can worry about quality pitches. Field your position. You've made a great pitch. You have to be a good fielder. We throw our guys into individuals. Right now we're starting our 15-on-1 individuals. Part of it is the COVID situation, but also this is part of what we do. We're able to stay through basically right around Thanksgiving to practice for full team practice. But right now our guys are in individuals, and of course we're doing simulated. We're doing bullpens, PFP type of stuff. But one thing we want them to do is we want them to be the best fielder they possibly can. So when they do throw a quality pitch, a ground ball back at them can either be two outs or it's a guaranteed one out. So we want them to be athletic that way. And then we have to believe that we're better in the box than anybody else. Okay? Understanding who you are. I think this becomes huge here, and I want to make sure I move here because I know we're on a time crunch. Strikeout versus contact pitcher. Okay, I think that guy that thinks he's got to be 92 to be a strikeout pitcher, that's not correct. You could throw 78 miles an hour if you can get to both sides of the plate and be able to spin a breaking ball or throw a changeup. You can be considered a strikeout pitcher. Your velocity has nothing to do with it. Contact, that's always great. Obviously, gets more guys involved. Depending on your defense, that can be a great thing or maybe not. But it also gives us an opportunity to go and attack hitters. So strikeout, contact, we want to be everybody within four pitches. If we can get a hitter out within four pitches, that will keep our guys in the game longer. What's your out pitch? Let them know what that is. We make our guys rate their pitches. So fastball is my first pitch. Change up down is my second pitch. Breaking ball is away my third pitch. Fastball away is my fourth pitch. So then if I'm calling the pitches, the catcher's calling the pitch, or if the pitcher's pretty well calling their own game, they understand what their strengths and weaknesses are. I think that becomes huge when knowing who you are. Wind up the stretch. For me, we'll talk about backside pinch, which is key for us. That should be the same. 0-2, what's your pitch and location? What is your out pitch? How am I going to get this guy out in the third pitch? 0-2, the old school, hey, it's a waste pitch. That we want it to be a quality pitch. We'll go back inside. We'll spin a breaking ball away. We'll elevate if needed. We'll bury something if we have to. Can you pitch backwards? Can we pitch in 2-0 counts, changeups, 2-0 breaking balls? As you get older, they're sitting pitches really at any age. They start to see pitches, sit pitches per count. Are you okay with hit by pitches? We talked about that. Tempo, and do you work fast? And are you a middle of the plate guy? I think that becomes huge. This is not a lesson. It's a game. Everybody's in the lesson world. How does it play at the plate becomes a big deal. I say it's not a lesson. It's a game. Hello. We can't just say, oh, coach, I feel really good. Well, you can't feel really good if the ball keeps getting worn off the left field fence or the right field fence. We have to be able to figure out how to ways to execute. So we want to make sure we execute one pitch at a time, turn negatives into a positive. They're going to happen. Homers are going to happen. Base hits are going to happen. Runs are going to score. You're going to throw bad pitches. They're going to be ears behind you. Make sure we can control what we can from weather, fielding condition, umpires, and so on. Confidence comes from preparation. I think if you work your butt off, the game becomes fun. It's the player's day. Let them go. And if they're prepared and they've worked at it and the coaches have worked at it, confidence comes from that. Body language awareness. Nobody wants to see the powder. I ask our guys on the mound all the time, what do you think the infielders think of you right now? When you're in the game, what type of energy do you bring? Punch them first. We always do, we don't want to sit and give a two spot up in the first. We want to be the aggressor. Understand the whole game, just not you on the mound. You're in the dugout, you're pitcher only. Watch how you're setting up. They're setting up pitchers or hitters. See when they're hit and run. What they're doing on the bases. Are they aggressive? Are they trying to attack? This can happen at all ages. Get them to understand the whole game. Watch the big league games, knowing what baseball is about, not just how they're pitching and what their lesson looked like that week. Difference between command and control. Command has definition. Control is over the plate. If you command and you get the ball to both sides of the plate, you're commanding the zone. Controlling, just because you're throwing a strike doesn't mean you have command. It just means you're throwing strikes. So mechanics for us, the importance of it, keep the most motion consistent and adjust and obviously help prevent injury. They do not guarantee wins, but hopefully it can help you stay on the mound. I think a lot of times There's two really good arms, or a good arm here on the right, and Don Mattingly is on the left. If you look, the backside pinch on each side, hitting and pitching to get yourself in position to go in the power position are very similar. For mass, we do a mechanical breakdown, three steps. It's 10 continuous reps every day. Our guys do this. This is a 3 to 5 minute max situation. I know some people are getting away from mechanics. I don't want guys to think that, you know, we just sit here and look like machines. But I do think they have to have a base, and I think they have to have awareness of what's happening within their motion. It's not just throw harder. It's locate better. So we want to be able to make adjustments there. Again, it's a 3 to 5 minute. Here's my picture with the Pope. Balance, backside pinch. This becomes a key thing. If anything's to be said here that makes sense to anyone, hopefully they catch anything out of this. It's called backside pinch, and we'll show how we do this. It allows your arm to catch up. So if you see on both these guys, you can see their left side, what we call that back hip, their left butt cheek right there is to the pitcher. Their right hip is pinched. No matter where it's at, it does not make a difference. Watch still footage, any type of balance. They all don't have to look like these guys. Okay, but if you look, they allow their arm to catch up, and that works with a lot of different words. We call it backside pinch. There's hinging, corkscrew, pocket the catcher. There's so many things that you can say. Whatever your terminology is, understand that your front side, your head, all falls apart when your backside does not allow it to catch up. Okay, right here, as you can see here, we do a PVC. This is how we start. We circle our guys up. I did this specific for today, but we circle our guys up here. And you can see in this here with our PVC stuff, we have PVC sitting up top, and they're getting their hip in this spot. Hopefully, Coach, can you see that where that finger pointer is there within the hip? Hopefully you can see it okay, and I know this is obviously virtual, but I think there's some people here on there. But as you can kind of see here, this hip, that's the biggest piece. We want to make sure that backside allows your hip to pinch, allows your arm to catch up, but also keeps you over the rubber. You are not pinching away. This for us is our biggest key when we're doing something. So this is a training piece for us, okay? The next thing we do is what we call our mass. This is part, we call it mass because it's a mechanical breakdown. We do it like a religion every day, okay? And you can see here, we have that PVC. This guy that's on the front left here, he uses it to line himself up. Other guys will use it, other guys will not. Okay, it's completely up to what their program is. You'll see some guys go leg high, some guys will go leg low. This is not a one-size-fit-all. We want them to be able to adjust to what their needs are. As you can see here in our balance, okay? As we can see within our balance here, that we've got balance and we have pinching. So we get up, so we do this time. So we say check in, set, balance, right here. Check in, set, balance. Pretty simple from that side. Again, I'm going to hit this one more time to make sure you can see it, because I think this might be the most valuable thing that I can do. Check in, set, balance. Ideally, get that leg underneath them, and then making sure that back hip is over the rubber. Our next step is landing. I had a presentation a couple years ago at this clinic, and they talked about that front side up. You want to have your, and you can see the backside pinch is there on all three of these guys. Pretty good arms. Okay. On all of these three, you will see once they land, that front side ideally is up. A couple years ago when I did that, I broke it down. It was the top 50 pitches in ERA, and I think 47 of them were front side up. This is what we call a stopper. If that glove side's up, it will force your backside to pitch. And I think it becomes a pretty key piece for us. Okay, I'm going to go ahead. You may go in here.
Do the same thing, please.
You can hear me. I was just trying to get some video here so you can hear me speaking. But they check in, they set, pinch, and land. Notice their front side. It does the same thing over and over again here. And again, some guys, and these guys are very similar on purpose because I didn't want to have, you know, 18 different guys because I think it makes it pretty hard. But you kind of see there's different body types. We've got a 6'6 guy in there. We've got some 6'2s. I've got a 5'10 in the back left. So no matter what your body type is, it all will work within them. Their levers will control what they do. Some guys are higher than others when we go to landing. So we do this. So our first step, that backside pinch, then this becomes our second step. So it goes check in, set, landing, and you saw that. Then we go to finish. This will be full body. So again, two of the best. We want to make sure that our glove side, our chest, and our elbow all are aligned. Those are together ideally. Now, there are a lot of different ways to look at it. There's a lot of different conversations to have with guys of spinning off, finishing to the plate, and so on. For us, this becomes a big piece for us is making sure we finish. I think the simplest way to think about pitching is linear, so we can stay within the lane. So we go back before we go forward and finish with our chest to the catcher. Some people say, well, hey, we watch some guys, especially guys that are in velo training. They're spinning, they're rotational. And that's fine. Every guy will be a little bit different. But for us, we want to make sure they're doing the best they can to stay linear and getting their chest to the plate. So as you can see, we will have different motions. And these guys are full go. This looks fairly mechanical. But to be honest, it's once they get going, we did this because obviously we're on video, but these are our three sets. These guys will start as a group, but once they start their program, depending on where their plyo days are, and again, some guys are doing plyo, some guys are not, but you'll start to see that everybody will be a little bit, you'll start to see everybody does this stuff a little bit different as a whole. I'll go one more time through for our third piece. Sorry for the video work. And then some of our drills, as we start to close down, I know we're getting close on time here, but some of our drills here, as we do, this is something we'll do a beam work, very similar. We talk about, again, staying linear. This is a guy that's 94, 96. It's really simple. It's super easy. His arm works that way. And a guy that had trouble spinning off because he could never stay control, his slider would cut, his fastball didn't have command on both sides of the plate. And this is pretty good. This has been pretty good for him. Another one is reverse throws off the mound. So this allows a guy and helps our guys when they're working backside pinch. So they'll go ahead and rotate, pinch to their backside. And that medi ball throw, again, is to a partner about 8 to 10 feet away, depending on what our distance is. So all they're doing is stepping back, getting their foot near the rubber, and finishing out front. Another one, a figure eight uphill. You can do this on a mound. It doesn't take anything, not much money for a basic medi ball. And I think this becomes slams. We've been really fortunate. I think a lot of this type of core work and a lot of our medi work has helped us. And I don't say this braggingly, but our velocities and our control has been substantially better within time. And a lot of it is technology without any question. But I think getting guys to buy in of the work ethic piece, the consistency that we're not changing everything from one week to the next, but then the intent. And you'll see the intent in all of these drills. Guys are full go. And we don't do these every day. You have to pick and choose. Obviously, workload's a big deal. Our long toss, we're huge into long toss. We're huge into load catch and so on. And I would be more than willing to share more information if anybody would like more information. But you kind of see here, and we're exploding as we go. These guys, and this is something that we do, we work uphill. If you do it on the mound, you can do it on the mound working uphill. We'll throw some bullpen stuff with reverse off the mound on the bullpen. Guys are working, getting over their front side with extension and so on. Okay? And again, anything that I might be able to go through or if anybody has any questions, here's some of my information. Bart, I think, or possibly you're on this call, but I think if we can, or if there's anything I can do to help anybody, I'd love to shoot me a call, or you can also get my office phone here, you know, at St. Leo. I'm glad to be able to help if I can, for sure. All right, let me get out of this.
OD, thank you, brother.
You got it, man. Thank you.
Really good stuff. I know that some of the questions, it's hard for some of our folks to like take everything in and then just shoot questions right back out. So let me ask you this. And I know you referenced your kid and playing travel baseball. How often do you recommend like a youth pitcher throwing off a mound? And then how often are they arm strengthening, and what are they doing for that? Like long toss, and is there anything else being done? Let's say 11 to 14 year old.
I would say 11, 14 year old. I think the biggest thing is, you know, a lot of those kids are playing a different position at that age. You know, it's not just pitcher only. So that will factor as part of it, I think, for sure. I think the biggest thing is, if they're going to throw on the weekend, is try to get on a mound during the week. And I'm just being realistic. Obviously, if you had more time, a better plan would be ideal of doing it more times. But the problem is, they're going to throw on a game and probably be the shortstop the next game. So their workload is going to be limited just because of what else they're going to do. So for me, I do think they need to get on the mound and practice, because if the only practice you have is on game day, it's hard to be good just on game day, especially if there's people stealing bases. And, you know, as they get older, there's a lot of other things to worry about than to just throw that strike. So you have to control the running game and things like that at that age. So I would try to get them on there and be able to get them on, you know, get them on the mound and be able to practice if it's a changeup, or depending on the age, obviously if they're throwing breaking balls, of practicing that. Long toss, into me, I would do it as much as you can within reason. If a kid is young and he can't throw hardly the next day, it's time to pull back. But most kids those age are want to throw every day. They either don't do it, they can't do it because if they're in the north or whatever the case is, or in facilities, they can only go a couple times a week. I would try, if I was up in the north, you know, if you can get in twice a week to long toss and get on a bullpen time, great. If you're down in the south, obviously that becomes easier. But I think if you can throw three times a week before game day, you're in really good shape. And if two of those days can be somewhat type of long toss, I don't put a number on it of how many pitches or a time, because I think what happens is, I have guys that will throw a long toss and it could take them 20 minutes to get through their long toss. And I have guys that throw for 10 minutes and throw the same amount of throws. But I kind of rate those guys as moderate fatigue, light fatigue, moderate fatigue, and full fatigue. So there's days, and part of their throwing program through the week, so we have a chart up so they know exactly what they're doing, is okay, you know, Bart, you're going to be a light fatigue day today. You're going to throw your bullpen tomorrow. We're going to be a full fatigue day the next day. Now, if you're a guy that's sore the next day, then a job for a coach is to be able to pull that kid off and say, hey, you don't need to throw today, because every kid wants to throw until they can. So I think as an adult, a dad, a coach, whatever, you need to be able to pull him back and say, okay, this is what we're going to do. You're not going to throw at all today, but when we do, we're going to air it out today. That makes sense?
Yes. I did have a question come in. Chris Kuzmich wanted to know if you could talk hip pinch again and any other front leg strengthening drills.
Good. Hip pinch. So the best part is, and I would encourage him to call me. That would be the ideal, and I can send him more. The hip pinch, I think the PVC is the best part. The way I explain it is that back hip, that becomes a pinch. So the pinch without being, you know, making sure it's appropriate, but that butt cheek pinch on the back side. So if you're right-handed, that right hip is pinched. And so what happens is you kind of get this angle. So that hip is right here and you've got the angle down. What happens is kids start to fall and float. And as soon as they start to fall and float, their arm never catches up unless they've got a quick arm. But at some point, that's not going to be the case. You can't do that, especially as they get physical. But if we can let them and help them pinch that back hip, you'll hear it called, you know, hinging now. I've seen people doing drills down, you know, a weight room bench to do it. For me, we like them to be somewhat tall. We like tall, long body guys. So what we'll do is we'll pre-pinch those guys. So they'll pinch before that. Once they set, their hips will pinch right away. And so all they have to do is lift their leg and go to the plate. Like I've got a 6'9 and 6'7 guy right now. Those guys don't need more movement. They need less movement. So we will pinch them right off the bat and then get them to lift their leg up and then go to the plate. So I would encourage, shoot me a call or whatever. I'd be happy to talk more detail for it.
Something else I know you can do with that is, and I'm with you. It was always like if you, the guys that that just slide step to the plate, it's like it's quick. There's nothing behind it. And the guys that leg lift to the plate, there's a lot behind it, but it's not quick enough. So you get into that hybrid kind of show spike, like front knee over back knee, and that creates that natural pinch or that natural.
Yes, absolutely.
Where it's kind of you're meshing the two worlds together of you're trying to be quick and get a little bit behind it. So you can just think of front knee over back knee, show your spikes where your front foot, you know, your feet are flat and you're just showing your spikes to the batter. Another visual for you. So
yeah, and the thing is, I think terminology becomes everything. Like you see people like arguing sometimes on Twitter or whatever. It's all the same thing. You know, it's just exactly there's especially pitching. Hitting's a whole different animal, but from pitching, everybody's trying to get to the same point, and that's allowing their arm to catch up because they're obviously it will give them more. You know, it will give them more range. It will allow their arm to catch up for their breaking ball. Will be better to change up and get to both sides of the plate. But I think the biggest thing is you don't want to pinch away from the rubber because a lot of times guys will try to pinch and load their hips and it will go away from the rubber and they're doing the same thing as jumping forward. So right. Trying to stay tall, and I'm not saying locked out, and I'm showing my hand. You don't want this, but you want to have an athletic movement that they can still stay tall, but they're not collapsed over because the second they collapse, I've never heard a pitching coach say, I'd rather have the 5'6 guy than the 6'6 guy. They want them tall for a reason. So I don't know if I can say that or not.
You can. That's an anecdotal claim that is very, very prevalent. So
unless he's 96, then it doesn't matter how tall he is.
That's right. I had a 5'11 closer one time that was 94, ended up in the big leagues. And had a specimen, you know, that's 6'5", and he also ended up in the big leagues. And guess what? They were just really good, and they competed and threw strikes. So
and that's the bottom line, Bart, is compete. Right.
Absolutely.
You can have all the knowledge in the world. If you don't know how to compete, it doesn't really matter.
That's right. Well, hey, folks, I know Rick has to go. He's in the middle of fall practice. I'll tell you this. He is super accessible. Shoot him an email. Give him a call. Go back into that notes pack. I know he put his contact info on there. Rick Odette, OD, I appreciate you, brother. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, my friend. Thank you.
All right, we heard pitching. Now let's hear hitting. We're going to take it to the Bashers out west, the United States Air Force Academy. All right, it is my pleasure here to welcome Assistant Coach Steve Serratore. I got that right?
Yes, you did. Can you hear me?
Got it in there. Atta baby. Steve Serratore, who's going to send me one of those sweet hats here very, very soon. But, Steve, thanks for joining us today, man. Thank you in advance, all of your players, man, for their service. I know it kind of goes without saying, and it's not cliche, and it really has some meaning behind it when I say, you know, from USA Baseball, we thank those guys for everything. They're 18 years old. They're signing up for that, man. It blows my mind. So to do what they're doing in addition to playing competitive major Division I baseball, it's unbelievable. So
yeah, it really is, and I appreciate that, and I thank you for having me on today. I can't honestly relate to our players in that aspect. I went to Kansas State and played my baseball, so it's very humility to really be around these guys to understand what it takes to be at that level, to play at this level, but also their commitments, obviously, to the academy, to the military. Something that's just cool for me to just sit back, understand, learn. Our head coach, Mike Kozlowski, was a former Air Force player himself. Flew C-17s over in Iraq for a while. I mean, it's some crazy things that he saw. Yeah, this is great life lessons to learn, and they're constantly teaching me just as much as I'm trying to teach them about hitting. So very rewarding. So I appreciate this, and it's a group effort from everybody in our society to do great things.
Awesome. Let's talk hitting, man. Let's get right into it.
Let's do it. So just have a presentation for you guys today. Share the video here. There we go. Okay. There we go. Now we're locked and loaded. Sorry about that, guys. But today we're just going to talk about total offense. I hope that everybody can take something from this between youth high school, obviously, and the coaching at the collegiate level. I think hitting gets really talked about in a, you want to talk the sexy terms about launch angle, exit velo, all this stuff. And the purpose of an offense is to score, just as simple as that. So we really try to cater our offense to try to accomplish that task by any means necessary. So we're just going to start breaking this down. Here's some information, how to get in touch with me, Twitter, email, anything that you guys need, please feel free. Give me a shout. Always available to answer any questions. So we'll dive in here. So these are just kind of the pillars of our offense. So I think the biggest thing is this identity mentality, and that starts from the coaching, is to understand what are you trying to instill in your players as they attack into a game. I mean, we really, again, being a military academy, we're always going to compete. We're always going to do those things. We're always going to put the pressure on the team to make a play against us. But it starts with coaching, just understanding what are you trying to accomplish and then what's the mentality of that and how do you really incorporate that. Going into our hitting approach, base running approach, goals as our offense from game and going in, we also do a hitting packet where it talks about season. We take the last five Mountain West Conference winners and we take their averages, batting average, slugging, all this stuff to understand, hey, these are kind of the baselines of what we need to do to be successful as the offense. So that's something to be important. Obviously, it's hard at the college, at the high school or youth level to understand, but I think it's important to have goals each and every day so that kids can strive for something in game to where, yeah, you might have taken a loss on the scoreboard, but did you get better today? Did you do the things that are going to help you be ready to go for postseason play and then going into swim mechanics after that? So, again, talking about identity and mentality. We kind of relate this in two different ways. What's the player's identity and what's the team's identity? So the player, and I think it's a very important thing to understand, what's the player's skill set? And that's not to be a bad thing. It's to understand. I mean, I know everybody wants to hit home runs and they want to hit the ball 400 feet. But sorry, the genetics just don't always incorporate that to be able to do that easier compared to other guys. So don't be shy about what your skill set is. Be proud because there's always a way to be productive for an offense. Preparation for our guys. How do we prepare during practice? How do we prepare in pregame? How do we do those things? As Coach Odette talked about, it being preparation instills the confidence, which is the third point, is that our guys have to understand that if you want to be confident as you walk up to the plate, you want to be confident running in the base pass, you got to put in the time. You got to put in the preparation, get the time in, and you can't just expect those things to happen. You have to prepare. For our team, again, going compete and relentless. I mean, that's something that gets instilled from our head coach. I mean, we're always competing day one. They come in, they're competing, then they got to compete in boot camp. They got to compete in a lot of different ways on the academy. We post our grades just right in front of the entire team on our little message board that we have in our hitting facility because it's about competing. You're going to compete against each other. You're going to compete against each other in practice and everything that you do. So that's something we try to really embark on right away. Full gas. I mean, we play at 5,000 feet elevation. I've heard many horror stories about the 15-1 game that gets all of a sudden, it's 13-15, it's the bottom of the eighth. So we always have to go full gas. You can't let up. You have to understand that anything can turn. One bad pitch and the team's back in if they have the momentum. So we have to be at full gas at all times. Pressure baseball. I think this can really relate to the youth and high school level. Again, everybody wants to create that sexy swing and they want to do something that a big leaguer does. But at the same time, if we can put as much pressure on the defense to make plays against us and really force them to have to be perfect on that side of the diamond, then we're going to really be in a good position to be successful. And that's strikeouts, whatever it is, getting on base, base pass, those all tie in the pressure baseball. The more pressure we can put on the defense to where they can't just focus on one thing. They got to worry about the guy at first, the guy at second, the guy at home plate, if he's going to bunt, if he's going to swing. That's just all that indecisiveness that can help us be successful. And then confidence in our team, confidence in what we're doing each and every day, that we're preparing in the right manner. We're going to do drills. We're going to have specifics and goals for that day of what we're trying to work on to where when they walk up to the plate, they have confidence and they have confidence in their teammates and they have confidence in everybody around them that we're trying to get the best outcome possible. So our hitting approach, we talked about preparation already. We don't really have to go into that too much. situation in the game. And again, I think this is something that as youth and high school coaches to understand and really break down situations in the game. Don't be afraid. If you can get as many live scrimmages as you can, just take 2-3 innings at the end of a practice, get coach pitch out there. He's throwing breaking balls, fastballs, whatever it is. We really want to get those situations in game type situations in a practice setting. So that way when our guys get up in those situations, they're not sped up. They have a pretty clear cut of what they're trying to do, what the best outcome for our team is going to be in that inning or that, and hopefully it can lead to a win at the end of the day. Going through skill set, again, understand your strength. Are you a speed guy? Are you a good bat handler guy? Do you hit well to the other field, the other side of the field? So these are things you have to understand as a hitter, and we're lucky and we're fortunate that by the time guys come to us, they pretty much made their identity on the skill set. I mean, that's just something you get 17, 18-year-olds, you really understand who they are as a player and where, again, when you get into those situations, how can you match up and be successful? Pitch selection. I mean, this is one of the biggest things that we preach. We do a lot of stuff. We do a 7-plate baseball drill. We have 7 balls lined up in front of the plate. Again, just recognizing pitches, pitch locations. Was it a 1? Was it a 2? Was it something that we speed up? We do colored balls. We do a lot of different things, rounds where they're trying to pick fastball or breaking ball spin, they're trying to pick that up out of the hand where it all of a sudden slows down during the game. That goes off pitchers matchups. Is a guy throwing 95? Is a guy throwing 82? I mean, those are things in the college game, velos can vary. So it's going to obviously dictate what we're going to try to do at the plate. And then going at the last part, just the mechanical swing, which is important. We don't want to dummy play that the swing mechanics aren't important. But, I mean, you look at a guy like Hunter Pence, man, like, I couldn't teach that swing. I mean, that swing is just bananas to me. But that dude puts barrel on ball, and it's a little unorthodox, but he does have some constants in his swing that does help him be successful. So that's something that we preach about. There's not one right way to hit. We try to take a guy's skill set, understand his body movements, and really try to give him a swing that makes sense. Just some constants that we talk about with our hitting approach. We're always going to be on time with fastball. I mean, unless the pitcher is really dictating that we can't, then we really, that he's going to be a lot more off-speed pitches, which happens more in the college game, high school, and youth. Really be on time with that fastball. It's the easiest pitch to hit. The ball doesn't move that much. Really have that timing up to the fastball and then work off of that. One pitch mentality, we're always going to work one pitch at a time. No matter if you work to 1-0, 2-0, whatever it is, you're not focused about getting in the box and trying to get to a 3-1 count. We're going to go one pitch at a time, be ready to go, be selective of what we're trying to get as a pitch, and be on time to it. Situational hitting. We talked about back control. That's something that, again, we have some bangers, but I think everybody needs to understand, yeah, we want to drive the ball for doubles, but you're down 1-2 and you got a guy at second base. I mean, you got to be able to understand that your job now is to get the fielder over and do a job for the team. So those are just little things to, again, practice those things in a live setting, even in BP rounds. I mean, understand, go through a list of stuff and have that preparation where it makes that a little bit easier that you practice it. And you don't just say, hey, we want to move the runner over in a game, but have you really practiced those things? I mean, that makes it a lot tougher. And then understanding your hot and cold zones. We do have a hit track machine at our indoor facility. Makes it a little easier when guys can look at the report. Hey, like, everybody thinks the middle end pitch is their best pitch, but it's like, yeah, you might hit that harder than the other pitches once in a while, but you're consistently putting more barrel contact with maybe exit velocity from 82 to 88, a little bit more consistent, or obviously we hope it's higher than that. Where, yeah, you're hitting the middle end pitch, you hit it 95, but you're only doing that once out of every 6 swings. So we have to understand what is our best zones to hit as an offense. So overall, this, we have 3 approaches. We make this off the pitch count as we see this unfolding in the at-bat. Our damage count, 0-0, 1-0, 2-0, 3-0, 3-1. Pretty simple as to why those are damage counts. One pitch in our hot zone. We're going to really be focused on whether that's a breaking ball or a fastball. We're going to really be zoned in on time to one pitch that we really want. And our main goal is the hard contact. Sometimes you can't control. You can do everything right, hit a laser to the center field, and you get out. That's fine. We're going to take that as a W all day long, trying to really put hard contact, especially in the damage count. Can't be behind. Can't get. We're not going to get cheated, or we're not going to really pull off, but we're going to take a nice aggressive swing to our desired pitch. Base count, 1-1, 1-1-2, 1-3-2. These are pitch counts that obviously at the college level, they're more of a you might get one or two different types of pitches. So we have to put ourselves in a position to hit more than one type of pitch. In that situation, we're working fastball middle of the field, trying to go gap to gap with it, and then trying to see the hanging breaking ball. We don't want to wait. He goes 0-1 and he flips that just loopy curveball right over the middle of the plate. That's probably going to be the next best thing you're going to see, because all of a sudden it gets to 0-2, and now this it's going to be really tough for you as a hitter. Line drive mentality. We're just really trying to focus on hitting the ball right over the shortstop or second baseman's head, understanding that, hey, I might not make hard contact because maybe he throws a different pitch, he throws me a little in or out, but to where if we have a good swing path and we can adjust, now we can actually might get a little bleeder. You might get a little jam job that squeaks through the infield, understanding that it's not necessarily about hard contact, but again, putting the ball in play with a little bit of a purpose in those desired counts. And then we get the two strikes. We're going to sacrifice, and this is more dictated off the guys that we see. If you're working with guys that are throwing fastballs in the upper 80s, low 9s, you can't cover every pitch. You can't cover if the guy's got a nice 2-3-pitch mix. You got to sacrifice something. And we're going to choose to sacrifice the inside corner of the plate with the fastball. As a pitching guy, I mean, it's not easy for guys to throw inside. If they can command that inside, it's going to be a tough day. I don't care if you throw 80 or a 90. You can command both sides of the plate. It makes it really tough. So we're going to sacrifice that inside corner, be able to cover the middle and fastball to the outside edge of the plate. At the youth high school level, you know the umpires aren't great, so they're going to call that ball 2-3 balls outside on the corner. So we have to be able to protect, fight it off, do what we can to try to get into a better count later on. Full coverage on the off-speed pitch. We're going to make our timing to where we might be slightly beat to the fastball, but most of the time in those type of counts, you're going to see a lot more off-speed pitches. So really trying to make sure we're not fooled in those situations. We're going to try to see the ball up. And again, put the ball in play. As simple as that. I mean, you just get into those situations, kids try to get too big. They're trying to make an outcome in two strikes like they're in a 2-0 count. But that really shouldn't be the goal. I mean, just put the ball in play. Make it simple on yourself. Make it a little bit easier on yourself. And just make the defense have to do something. You can get a routine ground ball and still screw it up somehow. So we're always going to do that. We always try to err on the side of ground balls compared to fly balls. Understanding that, hey, in this, again, youth high school level, you're not playing on gorgeous fields all the time. You're not dealing with infielders like Carlos Correa and all these guys. Sorry for the Houston Cheetah reference, but he's pretty good as a defender. Put the ball in play on the ground. Give yourself a chance to where it's a lot more action as an infielder to make a ground ball exchange and throw it accurately compared to a lazy fly ball that the guy just runs to and catches in the squad. So we try to err on the side of hitting a low line drive, hard ground ball through the infield to, again, force pressure on the defense. This is base running portion of this. Like I said, understand your skill set, and you don't need to be a 6'5 runner to steal bases. I was a 7'1, 7'2 runner, and I didn't steal a lot of bases, but I chose my times to steal. And I think anybody with the right concept and understanding of who they are can find a way to steal bases, ball in dirt, whatever it is. Force mistakes. We try to really talk with our guys. I mean, especially right now, we're doing false scrimmages. You know what? You're going to get out, and that's okay. Like, we don't want to make stupid outs, but at the same time, if the defense makes the right play, you could get out, and that's okay. You have to put that pressure on the defense to, again, they have that little bit of mentality. The pitcher's on the mound. They know you're a good running team or you're going to put the pressure. It's like all of a sudden he deviates his focus from the batter to you a little bit. Now you get a pitch that's not as executed as well, and now you get a better result as a hitter. So we can help our offense and our hitting based on our run. And then decision-making, understand where you're at in the game, situations in the game. Are you early in the game and it's pretty open to where you can run a little bit more? Are you later in the game where you need to kind of just piece more at-bats together to be successful? So we just try to understand those times to take risks. We're going to kind of hold back a little bit, but again, we're going to go full gas. We're going to put that pressure on as much as we can. So extra bases, this is a stat that we keep track of during all of our scrimmages and everything like that. And so for a guy like me or for anybody, we stolen base or ball in dirt, either way, you're getting second base or third base. It doesn't have to be a straight up steal to steal a base. It's stealing a base is just meaning you're taking a base advantage against the defense. So whether that's a ball in dirt or stolen base read, that's completely fine. Ball in dirt, we try to go, if we're in a hot situation, we're going to read the catcher's knees to where once he commits with his knees, he might just catch it really clean and be able to throw me out. That's fine. But that catcher has to get up, make a good exchange, and throw it accurately which is a lot harder to do than a lot of people think. At the high school and youth level, run. Just run as much as you can. I mean, it's everybody needs to understand. I think that's the biggest area in offense that we have to teach is base running, because, and I understand you only get maybe 2 hours in a practice and you got to make it pretty quick, but really take the time. And it's good work for your catchers to work ball and dirt. Good for your catchers to work just regular steals throwing it to second base or third base. So we want to try to put the pressure on as in defense or as an offense on the defense. Ball and dirt, if we're more in a yellow situation, we're going to read just if we can see the pitch angle out of the hand. So we have those little bit of timings to where, hey, we're going to give the hitter a chance here, or we're going to press the issue and try to get the next base. Our leads at first, second, and third, we do a new school and an old school lead at first base. We try to vary up the looks, again, just putting that pressure on. Steelbases.com has a lot of great information on how that new school lead works. One of our assistant coaches, Jim Raisinger, took the class that you can do through that. He really thought it was beneficial. He was actually one of the players at Dayton that really originated with Tyler Rico, who's with the Yankees right now, who really founded all this. So he's done a really good job with our offense to incorporate new and old school leads. But our base there is trying to get to 12-foot. That's just kind of our marker that we really feel like we can take that next base but still have a chance to get back. Second base, we're going to go a walking lead. We're going to go a little bit more new school with it, trying to be athletic. I mean, try to really gain some momentum, really put yourself into a good body position to where once I read that pitch, I'm instinctive and I'm reacting to it. Blocking is at third base, just keeping it light, keep it easy to where now, again, the batter or the runner's got momentum in his legs. He doesn't get stiff and get locked up and gets all this decision-making kind of screwed up. He can just be instinctive, but we're going to run. We're going to put that pressure on. Objective right there, find a way to second base, score on a double at first. 0-1 outs at second base. We're going to find a way to third because obviously we want to get there with less than two and be able to score on a single. No matter if you're a slow guy or a fast guy, we can still take proper angles and get ourselves into a good position that we should be able to score on any hit. And then at third base, just give the batter a chance. The aggressiveness of when I might take off, if it's a ball in dirt, maybe it's our eight-hole hitter against a tough matchup. If we're going to be a little bit more aggressive in that situation and try to steal a run, maybe the ball just kicks a little bit. But it's more about anticipating. We never want to wait. We're going to always anticipate something where we can react and be instinctive. So these are the goals for our offense. And I'm not going to go through all these. It would take too much time, but you guys can take a look at this. So we want to get the leadoff guy on at least more than half of the innings that we play. We want to really force that issue with zero outs. You can really dictate a lot of offensive play if you can just get the first guy on. And that's as simple. It can be a beam, walk, air, whatever it is. Getting that lead guy on is very, very important for our offense. Getting that starter out by the fifth. And now that might dictate for high school. We try to keep that in mind because we're going to play a three-game series, most teams. And obviously the starters are going to be their better arms. So we're trying to work to that bullpen, get there as fast as we can. 65% quality at bats. And you can see what we classify as a quality at bat there on the right. 70% with runners at third, less than two. Just again, taking advantage of those situations. We have to score as much as we can when we're in those type of situations. If we miss those opportunities, it's going to be really tough later in the game. Three freebies, stolen bases, ball and dirt are in there. It's pretty self-explanatory. We can get those. We can get three or four of those. We're going to get ourselves a good chance to score. One-to-one strikeout to walk ratio. We try to be on the other side. We try to be more, hopefully, in the 2-1, but that can get really tough. Hopefully, for the high school level, that can be something that you can all achieve. And again, put the ball in play. I mean, it gets as simple as that because we talk about in this swing a lot of the times with pro guys. There's a lot of swing and miss, but understand what the level you're playing. You're not facing Dustin May, who's throwing 95 mile an hour two seamers. I mean, you're not facing Clayton Kershaw throwing a 12-6 hammer. You got to be able to understand. You're facing most guys at the high school level are going to be 78 to 85. And those are type of velocities that you should be able to put the ball in play if you do a good job with your approach. Three extra base hits. These can be hustle doubles. This can be any way that you can get in the scoring position off one swing. Given, again, our chances and offense to dictate the next move, we want to play offense offensively. We don't want to be in a position to where we have to string three, four, five good at-bats to score. If we can cheat and we can get one, two swings and we can score off that, it makes it a lot easier for us to operate. and then 9 game changer at bats. You can see them on the right as well. Leadoff guys, 1-2 out extend. Well, I just want to dictate what that means. So 2 out extend, if you can get the first 2 guys get out, and then all of a sudden the guy's hitting at the plate with 2 outs, nobody on, he finds a way on base. We're driving that pitch count up. That can be after a long inning. All of a sudden, maybe it's 2-3 hits, guy gets a home run, there's 2 outs. And then again, if you can get back on base, it's just a downer for the pitcher or for a defense. Like, man, I got to stay out here now. I mean, that can just be demoralizing as a defense or a pitching staff. And that way we can have a little bit more fun ourselves. And the next 2-out RBIs, just kind of that dagger punch, just going right for the throat on that. And I know they're just key at-bats that we got to be able to capitalize once in a while, to where the defense and a pitching staff has to really work for that next inning. And an extra base hit is pretty self-explanatory. Statistics as to why we do what we do. These are the stats that I would lead you synergy as a scouting use. Like Doc said, that might not be very accessible for the high school and youth level. But, I mean, these are stats. You're talking about some of the best amateur players in the country. But at the end of the day, out of all the pitches that we saw last year or 2 years ago now with COVID season, 68% of those pitches were fastballs. That's why we're always on time with fastball, because it's more of the time we're going to get that pitch. It's an easier pitch to throw. It's an easier pitch to command. So we really want to set our sights on that fastball early. Average fastball at the divisional level that we saw that year was 89.3, which is pretty good velo. But at the same time, we're going to prepare to be able to handle the guy who's throwing 92+, 93+. But at the end of the day, we got to focus on our sights of being, a lot of guys are in that 87-92. It's pretty stock. It's pretty simple in that aspect, to where we should be able to handle that. Putting that pressure on the defense, like I talked about, more on the ground through the air. MLB fielding percentage in 2017, I got this from Coach Backage at the ABCA clinic in 2017. I just never really thought about it, but it just makes complete sense that 970 fielding percentage, every team in the big leagues had that. But if you look at that at the Division I level, it was only 17. And that's really telling you something, that, again, you're not working on the best fields. You're not working with the best infielders in the world. So put that pressure on the ground more than the air. A lot easier to catch a fly ball than it is to make a clean exchange on a ground ball, throw it accurately to the next base. These are just some stats, some run expectancy, depending on which guys, if you got runners on first, second, and third, what the outs dictated, what's the expectancy of you scoring runs. Again, we're trying to run and get in the scoring position. If we can get more guys to second base early in the inning, then that's going to prove to be a lot more successful. And then batting averages on the right side dictate off counts. I think that's 2018. I'm kind of getting blocked by the other videos on here on the right. So you guys can look at that and see if that can help you. And that might shift from the high school and youth level. But if we can get into damage counts, hitting counts, base counts, we're going to prove to be a lot more successful as an offense. So swing mechanic, this is just our overall concept. We want to create an explosive full body movement. And that really starts with our lower half. We want to have a swing that everybody talks about, this effortless bat speed. Well, how do you really get into that? Like, what does that mean? I think we dictate that as the lower half is going to be our drive. That's going to be our engine, to where my upper half can play really relaxed. It can play really simple throughout the swing. If we can be able to control our upper body to be consistent with a bat path, then let our lower half adjust to the pitch height and the speed to where it makes it just easier. We're trying to be very explosive. It's about being quick to the baseball and more being strong to the baseball. If we can be quicker to the baseball with a compact swing with some juice, to where now the batter can help himself, to where if I'm quick to the baseball, I can see that pitch longer. I can see that pitch a little bit easier, try to dictate spin and location, give myself a little bit of freedom to where I have that time. If we're trying to gear up and we're trying to swing hard, all of a sudden our body muscles don't move very well. They move stiff, they move rigid, but it also really just doesn't play into a baseball swing. I mean, you got little guys all over the place in Major League Baseball that are hitting home runs, and I hope I could bench more than some of those guys can, but they have more explosiveness in their swing because they're using loose levers. Relaxed, nice and easy, under control, and ready to explode. And then we have a doubles mentality. We're trying to hit that ball between 10 to 25 degrees. just a launch angle kind of a thing, to where we're trying to hit that ball head high over the infielder's head. And if we miss, we're going to miss just slightly underneath. We're going to possibly have a chance for a home run. If we miss slightly on top of the baseball, we're going to hit a hard one hopper ground ball through the infield. So having that room for error, which I think is something that everybody needs to understand, is that give yourself room for error. Don't make it to where you have to do everything right to be successful. Have room for error to still be successful, even when things don't go your way. So just going through just quick on the swing mechanics of all this, we start with our stance. And when you're building a guy's stance, understand what his deficiencies are. Is he a guy who really lunges on his front leg? Is he a guy who sits on his backside too long? Does he stride open? Does he stride close? And then build a stance that can help those deficiencies. To where all of a sudden, if you put him, if he's a front leg heavy guy, I'm probably going to try to widen him out a little bit more, really try to get him to understand to stay on his backside, to where if he doesn't have a long stride to really get heavy on his front foot, we can try to help him out and just put him in a better place to be successful. As we start our load, we want to load in that backside, in that back hip area, really keeping ourselves stacked up. A good indication if a guy is in a good launch position is if when he lands at foot strike, what's his back shin telling you? Is his back shin staying pretty vertical and stacked up to where he's fully engaged in the ground? He might be tilting his back knee towards the pitcher already as he's taking that stride, where he doesn't have the strength in his backside. So we really want to try to stay in a good athletic position. Easy assimilation for that is just a back squat. I mean, understand that's you've got 315 on the bar. How are you going to be able to handle it? You got 200 on the bar for a high school kid. How can you handle that and be explosive to get that bar up? So getting into that powerful position as much as we can in our load, to where once we land, we're in that position at launch. Separation in our hands that we're talking about. We try to talk with our guys. We don't want to get too far off that back shoulder, because if I get more off that back shoulder and I reach, now my front arm has to dictate a more extended load, to where now we could be a little bit slower. We could be a little bit more of an arm bar swing. We want to have room. If you're going to throw a punch at a person, don't do it. But if you're going to, you're not going to throw that punch from back here. You're going to get loaded up right here, really getting that scap loaded up and be able to drive something with some force. So we want to get in that good separation. Forward move, like we talked about, we want to stay in that backside as long as we can. Landing here, the only thing the front foot does on the land is really hold balance. We don't want to exert any energy in that front leg if we can. We really want to stay in that position where it looks like when you land, you're 50-50, but you should be a little bit more like 70-30 as far as distribution of my strength in my legs. Posture, getting again that back squat position, having our chest is slightly over our toes. We're getting hinged up into our hip to where we have that good V working from the knee, hip, and shoulder to where we're going to be able to be stacked. That's our strongest position we can get to, where we can be quick and explosive. One movement, and we're going to go and attack. Lower half sequence. So really starting from that back hip, as I start to rotate, everybody talks about squishing the bug, which it's a good term for youth kids just to kind of give them an idea of what that means. But really it's when that back knee and that back hip starts to deliver. If I can keep that back foot on the ground for as long as I can, and then that foot will naturally rotate on its own. It's the only way it can really clear. So it's not just squish the bug and just spin your back foot. That doesn't give you any strength in the swing moving forward. We want to make that back move forward and then hold that strength in our backside all the way through the swing, through contact, and release through the hands. Top half, the top and lower half work together. Everybody talked about staying inside the ball, which is important. But to understand, if you can't get inside the baseball, it's probably because your sequence is wrong. We always want to start our hands. We're going to really get that back hip started, and that backside and my hands are going to work as a rubber band, where once that backside goes, my hands are going to trail right behind and be the accelerator, where now my hands quite easy inside the baseball. If my hips start early, now my hands can work clear inside of my body, work tight along my body. If the hands work first, then we're going to want to work negative. We're going to want to work around the baseball. So understand that back hip's got to fire just slightly first, to where now our hands just trail right behind in a controlled manner. That half, we talk about, we want to give ourselves, again, room for error. So we're not trying to create just a straight flat fat path, but we're going to try to kind of lean towards that way, where, again, I'm making contact through the baseball, and if I catch it on the end of the bat or the inside part of the bat, if I still have that acceleration moving through the middle of the field, I still got a shot for a hit. And then the release, working through the extension part of the swing after contact. Don't just be too quick to cut off my swing, to finish over my shoulder. Really try to think about, if I hit a ball right here, I'm going to try to hit a ball in front of that and a ball in front of that, and really work my bat path through the swing. Really try not to cut it off too early. We're not finishing in that uncomfortable manner. We really want to let our hands fly and release through that middle of the field. Some drills, and I apologize. I had video of all this, of the swing mechanics and the drills. I'm working with a four-year-old iPad that didn't want to edit for me, so I didn't think that having a 14, 15-minute video would help be very helpful. So I'll make sure to send those to Mr. Bartman here in the next couple of days, so that hopefully the coaches on here can take some of these drills with them. Probably most of these you guys have done or seen Nolan Arenado drills. So we want to create that step back. You can do a hop back with it. But again, we're trying to free our legs to move quickly. I think a lot of kids get stuck in their back hip because they just don't feel like they can really move in that position. So we want to free our legs up to work to where they just take that slight step back. They're loading, gaining that separation. We're going to create momentum through our swing. Happy Gilmore drill, again, loosening up our legs. These are good drills that we do with our guys, more for a pre-practice or a pre-game, just cues. We want to create little cues in their head of what their deficiencies are, but again, hopefully that we can correct them a little bit easier with just a simple cue in my head. Happy Gilmore is just that walkthrough drill. If you haven't seen the movie, it's one of my favorites, so go nuts. So where we're just going to create that easy bat path, working through that middle of the field. Behind toss, I think this is a really good drill if you have guys who land heavy on their front leg, or if you have guys that aren't understanding how to get synced into their back hip and where they create a plane working. We don't want to drag our barrel from behind, but we want to work to where it's connected from the back hip, to where now when I start to work, I can work tight along my body, create a good plane to where when I go through the zone, it's a little bit flatter and should be able to do that. You just flip the ball right from behind him, throw it right through the middle of the plate to where he's got to keep his front shoulders or his shoulders relaxed. A lot of guys will want to turn in, and if I turn in, all of a sudden I'm just going to want to pull out to where we're going to keep our top half relaxed, really let our back hip do all the work to where now I can make just a clean, simple move with my backside and hands coming through. And then the front side toss, we do more than one angle. We usually go open side or close side. Front side would be on the guy's pull side, so you just stand a little bit more like 45 degrees on his pull side. You're flipping him to the middle outside part of the plate to where, again, if he caves in with his front shoulder, if he gets really opened up and turns open too quick with his shoulders, to where he's got to let that ball travel across his face. And really, again, we're working in a linear pattern. We're trying to work in a linear pattern. There's a rotation, obviously, in a swing, but we don't want to create a rotation swing. We want to create a linear swing that's going to be able to work to all fields. And in summary right here, hopefully my time's pretty good. I tried to practice a few times and was doing pretty good. We want to be a Swiss Army knife as an offense. There's not more than one way to score. We have to be able to do as an offense to find other ways. And again, understand your skill set. Are you a guy that can run and bring that element to an offense? Are you a banger type guy who can really put the ball in the air and really do some damage for us? But everybody's got to be able to bunt. You have your big lefty four-hole hitter, and he's facing a lefty with a good slider. He might, and they're giving him a whole left side of the field. If we can drop down a bunt and find a way on, all of our guys need to be able to do those things, hit and run, put the ball on the ground. So we practice those every day. And then the Wolfpack right here, this is bringing back my K-State days. I talked with Coach Barman a little bit before, was playing under Coach Brad Hill. This was more of a concept that was brought in by one of our assistants, but the quote is, for the strength of the pack is the wolf, and for the strength of the wolf is the pack. So what's that meaning is that we individually can bring something to an offense. We each can bring a skill set. We each can bring an approach that's going to prove to be successful to our offense. But if one guy doesn't get the job, then the next guy's got to be able to get the job done. And it frees our guys to not think that they have the whole weight on their shoulders to get the job done, that they know that, hey, the guy behind me is going to be able to do it. You have the confidence in him. You've seen him prepare to where this is a unit. It takes more than one wolf to take down the buffalo. You got to have more than one guy to be able to take down that guy that's the ace of a high school staff. He might be a draft pick. Maybe the guy doesn't get him, but he works a big pitch count. He gets him in an 8-9 pitch at bat. where all of a sudden the next guy's, he's tired for the next guy hitting, and he gets the juicy ball to hit and get the guy in to score. So we can work together as an offense and really keep it to where, as a unit, we're going to score runs. And that, at the end of the day, that's all that's most important. And then the last thing I'm just going to show you, this is our hitting packet for our hitters right here. So going through, this talks about all of our hitting, talks about all of our approaches. And then the back right here, we just have post-game evals right here. I'll try to post it up a little bit. Just going through how the pitcher was, how the hitter was feeling. What pitches did he see? Did he feel like he saw the ball well? And being honest with yourself after a scrimmage or a game, that I can use this as an adjustment tool. I can use this as, hey, this is my weekly kind of progression into what I'm trying to develop as a hitter. You don't want to be playing the best baseball in August. You want to play your best baseball in June, July, or June and May, so where you have that steady progression of information. And I urge you guys to make a hitting packet to where, again, it kind of relates and can kind of give the information to your players, where they can take it home, they can study it, they can understand how this can help them as a hitter. And we just want to make it easier for our hitters. At the end of the day, this is an offense, it's not a hitter. And that's hard in baseball because it can get really individualized, but at the end of the day, we're trying to win ball games and then score more runs than the other team. So that's really all I got. Please feel free, again, if you need some information or you need some questions, just give me a shout at any time on Twitter, email. I can, if you give me that, I'll give you my phone number. We can always connect in so many ways. But I want to thank Coach Bartman for having me on. This has been a complete pleasure to really see all these coaches. Doc Swender, I know him well. The dude's a stud. He's actually going to be getting one of these hats, Mr. Bartman. Sorry to say that, but in a couple hours, he's going to be getting one of these hats. So you might have to come up to Minnesota. Granted, I'm only here for 2 days, but you might have to come get your hat or come out to the Air Force Academy and see how it's all about.
We'd love to. We'd love to. I've got a tentative meeting scheduled out in the Springs with MLBPAA, so I'll probably just swing by and see you at some point when I'm out there.
Oh, absolutely. Come out, get some swings. Got the 5,000 feet of elevation. It's a beautiful thing.
You don't want to see me hit, my friend. I was a defensive catcher. You know what they say about good defensive catchers who don't play at a high level? They can't hit. Part of it. Maybe I can after watching your presentation, man. Coach Serratore, thank you so much. I know you are not in the Springs right now. You're traveling. You fit us in this week, man. I really appreciate it. Sincerely, thank you so much for jumping in.
No problem. Thank you very much.
Looking at what time it is, we're going to not a lot of hitting questions in the Q&A. So like Coach said, he is very accessible on social media and on email. Please give him a shout directly. I do need to say that here at 3 o'clock Eastern in 20 minutes, you can go to usabaseballshop.com once again and use code CLINIC29. That is CLINIC29, the 20% off your entire order for the next 24 hours. Also, a lot of our new era hats are like 50% off for some reason right before the holidays. So check those out. We've got the USA Baseball Gators, the Baseball is a Mask, all that good stuff. Check it out. Visit usabdevelops.com for all of your free developmental needs. If you need any assistance whatsoever or have any questions about any of our educational offerings at USA Baseball, certification, long-term athlete development plan, background checks, any of it, let me know, man. Email me, man or woman, whoever's listening. Email me directly, Andrew Bartman at usabaseball.com. Like Coach said, I'll email you back. You'll have my cell number. Shoot me a text. Give me a shout on social media, DM me, whatever. We want to put as many great resources in your hands as possible, and we want to reach as many leagues and as many coaches as possible with them. So please give me a shout. Let us know how we can help you. We're working on some new things. Virtual clinics will roll on. We already have 4 speakers for next week lined up. Next week is an evening clinic, 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern time. We've got Jim Chester, head coach at Gardner-Webb University, Ray Ricker with the Philadelphia Phillies, Matt Howard, who's a Major League Baseball alum and head coach at IU Kokomo right now, and a legend in the high school coaching ranks, Mark Johnson at Cherry Creek High School in Colorado. Has had so many big leaguers, so many big-time players come through there. Coach Johnson does a great job. So excited to have all of them and a couple more join us next week. Until then, I am Andrew Bartman, Director of Coaching Development at USA Baseball. Thanks for joining us today. Thanks for getting better. We appreciate your commitment to growing our game.